told me, "Hey, I got something fantastic to tell you." He said, "I am affiliated with people that speak with the spirits of the dead. How would you like to talk to the spirit of your dead mother?" And I was shocked. I was shocked. He said, "You wouldn't be afraid of talking to the spirit of your dead mother, would you?" Well, I said, "I'll tell you what, I would have to give that some thought, because it's something I never thought about before in my life."
Heart Research Center presents A Trip into the Supernatural with best-selling author Roger Morneau. While still a young man in the city of Montreal, Roger Morneau became involved in the worship of demons. In this two-part series, Roger gives us a first-hand account of his harrowing brush with the powers of darkness and, ultimately, his divine rescue. Also joining him are Cyril and Cynthia Grossi, the very couple who first pointed Roger from the darkness to the light. Conducting this exclusive interview are Dan and Karen Houghton of Heart Research Center. Let's now join the Houghtons and Roger Morneau as we together enter part one of A Trip into the Supernatural.
How in the world did you ever get involved in praying to demon spirits?
Well, when I came out of the Navy after World War II, I was looking for to take up a trade in Montreal, Canada. And at that time, I ran across a fellow that had been on a particular ship with me. And he said, "Hey, Morneau, you're alive. How nice to meet you." He said, "Let's have a dinner tonight." I said to my boss, "Can I have the evening off?" Because I was the assistant to the Windsor bowling alleys and billiard, you know. It's the high-class place in Montreal where all the dress manufacturing people go and relax. So I got the evening off and I went out, we went out to have dinner. He told me, "Hey, I got something fantastic to tell you." He said, "I am affiliated with people that speak with the spirits of the dead. How would you like to talk to the spirit of your dead mother?" And I was shocked. I was shocked. He said, "You wouldn't be afraid of talking to the spirit of your dead mother, would you?" Well, I said, "I'll tell you what, I would have to give that some thought, because it's something I never thought about before in my life."
Most of us probably haven't, a little afraid of something like that.
Well, he says, you know, it's written all over your face. You're afraid of going to a seance. But he says, "I know you. You're going to come." And then he started telling me how brave I was when I was aboard ship, you know, different things. He says, "You're not the same man. You've changed. You're chicken." That's all I needed to hear. I said, "When do we go to a seance?" So one Saturday evening, we were in the place. It was our first time. Very beautiful place. The medium was a lady. She had a gorgeous new home in Montreal. And there were about 20 invited guests there, which I was one of them. And she communicated with the spirits for different people there, and gave, telling them what the spirits said. And then there was one lady that had been talking almost continually before the seance started, and she didn't believe in the dead appearing and all of this and all that. And she said, "Well, I would have to see my dead sister," she says, "to believe it." So while this the seance was going, one man said, "I would like to talk to my friend that died 6 months ago, but I don't want him to appear. Just want to talk to him, because he says, I don't trust you talking to my friend for me." So the medium says, "Let me inquire of the spirit." "Yeah, the spirit will talk with you." And that big masculine voice was heard in the place. It says, "Hi, Frank. It's nice of you to ask for me to talk with you." And they had a little chat. And after it was over, Frank says, "This is the greatest thing on earth. to be able to talk with the spirits of the dead. Then the medium said, "We have a very special surprise tonight for you people. A spirit will manifest itself openly here in a few minutes, and it's like a big gust of wind hit the building and right through the wall." Now the lights weren't terribly bright, but they were like living room lights, a couple of floor lamps and maybe some of these, and that translucent being seemed to come right out of the wall.
How did you feel right at that moment?
It's almost like my heart stopped a little bit. Okay. You know, very weird feeling. So it was a lady in a beautiful evening gown, floor length. And she said to Mary, "My dear sister, you are so wonderful to have asked for me." And Mary fainted and fell right off her chair on the floor. And a couple of guys jumped up and picked her up, and spirit gone. And that was the beginning of it.
That's how you got into it.
Yeah, that's the way I got into it. After a while, you see, there's something interesting about the human mind. You can adjust an awful lot of stuff. You can adjust to a lot of things that would terrify you to begin with. After a while, they become common and ordinary.
So you mean contact with the supernatural can become commonplace and ordinary and doesn't bother anybody?
Yeah.
In other words, the more that you do it, you're not uncomfortable.
That's
it's
right.
It's just not an uneasy feeling.
Yeah.
So how did you feel about it?
Then I got into a secret society that worshiped the spirits, you see.
How is that different from the seance, Roger?
It happens that the seance are not involving in many ways. But when you get into a secret society of spirit worshippers, then, and especially when you're invited there by the direction of the higher-ups in the spirit world, you never get out of there alive. And this is exactly what my friend and I were up against. We didn't know anything about it. And there was a very, very popular big band leader.
Jazz musician.
Band, yeah. Very famous. Played a lot in Montreal, Canada, Vancouver, the big cities. And one night we went to one of these seances, and he was with his wife. Now the spirits had told him what to do. Spirit told him, "There's two of these guys, give the names, and your wife will want to talk, will make it so that your wife will want to talk to the medium when you say that you want to go home because you're tired. As soon as you see that these guys are starting to want to leave, then leave with them at the same time. And as you get outdoors, you ask them if they're driving. They'll say, no, they're going to take the tramway a couple blocks away. Well, you invite them to get in your car with you, and that you will take them to a fancy restaurant and treat them to some good food and to talk about the Merchant Navy. And that's what the guy did. And there we were in this plush restaurant. Pulled into a little alley, and I can still see it like it was yesterday. Just enough room to pass the car, back alley, that happened to give on a restaurant that was on St. Catherine's Street, which is the main street of Montreal. And that was quite an evening.
So, Roger, you're at this restaurant. What happened?
Well, after we were seated, in entering there, the place was just full, packed tight. But there was a couple of tables against a wall that had a reservation sign on it. And the owner of the place recognized the band leader and came and said, "Good evening, and you gentlemen want a table. So you're one of the reserve people." So we sat there, and we had our favorite alcoholic beverages, you know. And as we talked, the band leader says, "How long have you fellows been involved with sorcery?" And he chopped us a little bit, and I said, "Exactly what do you mean?" "Well," he said, "you know, what you people are doing, talking to the supposed spirits of the dead. He says, this is silly.
And this man had been at the seance with you.
Yeah, oh yeah.
And he's telling you that it's silly what you've just done.
Because see, my wife, he says, goes to the seances because she gets comfort and she gets something good out of it, good feeling out of it. And she lives for what the spirits are going to see that the future is going to be like. To me, he says, I can't bother with this stuff. He says, I want power. I go right to the source of power. And he says, how do you think that I became famous the way that I am? Well, I said, you must have had some good luck. Well, he says, there's no such thing as good luck. He says, there's either some power working for you somewhere, or you don't get ahead in this world. Not in my type of occupation. So it went from there. We got talking about spirit worship.
Did it intrigue you? Did it make you want to find out more about what exactly he was talking about?
Yeah. So he said the supposed spirits of the dead that you're talking with are demon spirits. Your fallen angels. Your beautiful beings.
Just set it out, just like
oh,
that.
Oh, yeah.
It didn't make you uneasy when he said they were
well, you know, it shocked you a little bit, you know. Something that you first hear mentioned to you. He said, you guys have got a great future ahead of you. Because we've been told, the high priest of our society, secret society, has been told that the master has very special plans for you too.
Now, what did he mean by the master?
Satan. And we were interested to hear more about it. And he told us, he says, look, we worship spirits. We worship Lucifer and all his angels. They're just as beautiful as they did before they were cast out of heaven. He says, there was a misunderstanding in the whole thing, he says, among the inhabitants of the galaxies. And he says, our master was misunderstood. And God did not bear with him like he does with people that make mistakes today. So we're in a warfare, good against evil. And we happen to be the evil ones, but we're not that bad. He says, I look at this business between the force of good and evil. He says, you believe in one person believe in God, and the other one believes in Lucifer. It's like politics.
So the great controversy mm-hmm. is real. And you've heard someone talk about it that's on the other side.
Mm-hmm. And to these people, they are sold to the fact that Christ will not return to this planet with power and great glory. He's going to abdicate all claims to the planet because the high priest once said that Christ will abdicate all claim to the planet because he knows that it is lawfully and rightfully Satan's. And at that time, he says, Lucifer, you mentioned Lucifer a lot of times, but he mentioned Satan also. He says, the master, usually they like to talk about the master. The master will resurrect his people from the grave.
Now, George is telling you all this, or the high priest?
George.
Okay, when the evening wound down and you're putting a cap on all that, mm-hmm. you guys had consumed some alcohol.
Yeah.
And you, did you feel like that there was kind of a one-shot deal? You didn't know if it ever happened again? What happened after
well,
that?
Well, he said, no, I said, listen, guys. He said, I like to have you, he says, meet some of our people. What about next week, Wednesday evening? I'll pick you up at your place and you're invited to one of our services
like a church service,
something similar like that. It's a testimonial to the spirits, well, how the spirits have blessed your life. So when we left there, I said to myself, this guy's half drunk. I'm not gonna hear from him again, you know. But it was true. Wednesday night came, he was there with his big Lincoln, step in, and we went to one of the most beautiful area of Montreal. The place was a mansion. Now, a mansion is usually very large. We'll call this a small mansion. It was beautiful. Most beautiful place. Yeah.
Roger, your friend George took you and Roland to this mansion where people worshipped the demons. Mm-hmm. What was it like there? What kind of people were there?
Well, it was a big surprise for me, as I kind of made up my mind, an idea that they were going to be rough-looking characters. But as we entered the place, I was amazed to see that they were all very well-dressed, well-mannered, and that a lot of the people, as we were being introduced to people, were professionals, doctors, attorneys, a lot of business people. And see what they had? They had a praise session to the gods, which is the spirit counselors, which are in charge of legions of spirits, of demon spirits. And they talk about what the Lord of their lives has done for them, because they call on particular spirits, like the god Nehushtan, which you read in 2 Kings about. The Israelites worshipped the golden serpent that Moses had made. Mm-hmm. Well, behind the spirit worship, behind that, they were worshipping the serpent. They were actually worshipping this spirit Nehushtan. And the same spirit Nehushtan is, the priest was telling us, that the medical doctor that was telling us how he was making operations that had never been made before, because people had to be awake, have no feeling. He was able to, carry on the surgeries that had not been done before. Mm-hmm. But the spirits would give that capacity to be able to operate without people feeling any pain and things. And also without no problem with the blood, because as he would cut his incision, because the incision's everything open and with no blood running. Mm-hmm. So he could do the work that has not been done before.
So. Now, I recall reading in your book that at this praise worship service they had, they would sing hymns. Why would they sing hymns in a demon worship?
Yeah, this was kind of a big surprise to me when that took place. The priest said, hey, let's go down to the worship room of the gods and have a praise session, a singing session. So we go down there, and what did you think did they pass around? Church hymnals, Christian church hymnals. And I couldn't believe this. I said, what's his business? So the priest says, well, now, he says, for those of you that are new, let me tell you that this is the most feasible way, he says, to please the spirits. It's to deride Christ and his people, and his church and all that. So they sing out of Christian hymnals.
They didn't sing Christian words to the hymns, however.
Well, they changed a lot of them. Mm-hmm. Yeah,
and not for the good.
It's a form of blasphemy. Yeah. Mm. Such as you see today in the rock music world, you see the entertainers, they have these crosses. Mm-hmm. Ladies got earrings, crosses. Mm-hmm. The guys got the cross. This is a form of blasphemy, a form of deriding Christ. You see. Spirits cause the people to do that, to find pleasure in wearing this type of emblem, which is the cross is the emblem of the crucifixion of Christ to the Christians.
So what were your impressions the first time you went down into that worship room?
Well, it was, we'd been there maybe a half a dozen times, and the high priest told us after the meeting was over, he wanted to talk to us. My friend and I. So after the most people had left, he says, the master of my life has revealed to me that it is time for you people to become acquainted with the worship room of the gods. Well, we started to move toward a beautiful grand staircase. Beautiful. The banister was huge. It was massive. And the wrought iron work that they had done, it was super. The beautiful decorations on the walls, the chandelier on the first landing. See, that was the first landing. You go down about 8 or 10 steps and you had the first landing. It was huge and beautiful. The light arrangement was the nicest I had ever seen in my life. When we got into this sanctuary area, it wasn't very brightly lit, but everything was magnified the beauty of certain things. A lot of the things were gold-plated, or gold trims. See, the little altars where they had the spirits that had materialized, they photographed them, and then they had paintings made of them. And there was probably about maybe 100 of those around the place.
Sort of like a shrine?
Yeah, and underneath there was a little altar where you have incense and things that they would use in their prayer sessions and things like that, devotions to certain spirits. And some of the objects in there, the priest said, were solid gold. Mm. It was a unique experience to see that.
So how did you feel when you walked into that room?
I felt that these people had power, and they had a lot of it.
Did that attract you?
Yes and no.
You had mixed feelings about it?
I had mixed feelings about it, yeah. Because to a certain extent, things looked so good and sounded so good to us. But you see, I'd been brought up in a Christian home where my parents had told us we were 8 children in the family. And especially the older ones, you know. My dad says, well, you know, if you get involved in wrongdoing, you're going to have to pay the price. There's always a cost for everything in this world. So this thought kept creeping into my mind. Just how far you go with these spirits before we start paying the price. See?
So it made you just a little bit nervous.
Oh, yes.
But yet you kept going back.
Oh, there was no way out. Because that's what we're told.
You knew at that time.
Yeah.
So you were moving forward more on fear.
More on fear, yes. Because the high priest said that the master had special plans for us in our lives. And that no one ever went into the society unless they were invited by the spirits. See, so that was made very clear. And he also expressed to us the danger, explained to us the danger of going against the will of the spirits. And he mentioned about this one man and his wife that live in a fireproof building in Montreal. The place burned right down with him in it. Mm-hmm. He was one of their members that had decided that, well, he wanted to think things over. He was not going to get initiated at a time that the spirit said he would like him to be initiated into the society.
So in reality, Roger, you were chosen mm-hmm. by high-powered demon spirits yeah. to be a part of their human, special, privileged mm-hmm. group.
You see, these people in Montreal, the society, like the priest mentioned, there's thousands of spirit worshippers in only different societies of spirit worshippers in this world. But he says, we are the elite. We know the real truth about the master and his angels. And they are not hideous looking beings. They are gorgeous creatures. And from the paintings that they had on the walls of that worship room, they were unique beings. Especially there was a painting full length painting of the fallen Lucifer above his altar. And that was very fascinating, because he looked like a man of great intellect, high forehead, the way that he looked with his eyes, the way he had the eyes looking. It gave you a depth of perception of somebody that is very, very knowledgeable and
powerful.
And powerful, yeah.
So Roger, this high priest that you talked about, he is the one that ushered you down into the worship room. Mm-hmm. Was he also the one that led out in the praise sessions that you talked about?
Yes, and he had an assistant also, another priest.
Okay. Now, when you would go to these praise sessions, mm-hmm. what kinds of things happened at those sessions?
Well, there's a lot of success stories.
Positive mental attitude kinds of things?
Well, yes, a lot of success stories. The masters has done this for me and that for me. I remember one lumber dealer, he had like half a dozen different operations in France and Quebec. And everything that he touched seemed to turn to money. You know? And he was telling about it. And then there's this other person that was a clairvoyant that would work only for the wealthy people, only for the super wealthy. He says, I have the know-how, they have the means, let them pay. So he advised in business transactions. They would come to him and say, listen, I look at this deal that I might get, you know, this factory or whatever it is, like, because this person was interested in industrial real estate, see. And he would talk to the spirit, and then the spirit was audible to him. See, you could hear the spirit talk to him, but the man did not hear. So the spirit was telling the clairvoyant what, he called himself an astrologer, reading the moons and the stars and, you know.
Now, what was the term you used for his title, this man?
Clairvoyant.
Oh, clairvoyant. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Clairvoyant. Yes, and it was interesting. This person stood up and says, I had a nice little experience last week. And he says, the master, he says, they take care of you. This lady and her husband brought him to this astrologer a bundle of money. They said, this is the deal that you, and he works at only on percentages. Only on percentages. He doesn't work for set amounts of money. Only percentages of what the people are going to make. So he said, they brought me a substantial amount of money. And they were very happy with it, and I thought it was very reasonable. But then my guide, spirit, says, ask them when they're going to give you the other $1,700 that is really yours. And he says to the folks, I would like to know now, before we leave here, when will you have the $1,700 to give me that makes up my part of, you know, rightful part of the deal? The wife fainted, and the husband says, we'll have the money for you within 24 hours. So that was this type of priest.
So he was thanking the demons for helping him to know that.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Demon spirits, yeah.
At what point did this demon worship start to affect you personally, Roger?
Well, it wasn't too long that the priest mentioned to us that the time had arrived for us to start trusting the spirits and give the spirits a chance to work for us. And there was a number of gifts that you could choose from, you see. And I used to play the horses, some. Not knowledgeable at all. I used to go to those bookies, you know, play the horses so often. But I said, hey, I would like to be able to, for the spirit to instruct me on the numbers and the name of the horses that's going to win, you know, at Belmont or some other racetracks like that, make myself a little money. So the priest says, it'll be given you. And sure enough, one night I fell into a trance or dreamed the thing. I don't know exactly what happened, but I saw three races that were really going to pay big. And these horses were dummies, so to speak. You know what I mean? They were not really good horses. They were like the one horse paid 21-1 because he was that poor, right? The chance of winning was so poor that they paid 21-1 on him. And it showed me I saw the board at the bookie and the number on it. And I went there, and they said it was going to be on Saturday. That was like on Wednesday, a few days later, it was Saturday. I went there, and sure enough, there they were on the boards. I went to the wicket and handed some money and got myself a winner. Now I said, well, I'm a little crazy. I ought to put more money on there. So I put $20 onto the next horse. And that paid 21-1. So, you know, I left there with maybe $400 or $500 in my hands. And I started to do that. In this case, I went directly down to the finest men's shop on St. Catherine Street and bought myself a $200 suit.
And in 1946, a $200 suit was...
In 1946, people used to work at the RCA Victor, where I had worked before I went to the Navy, for $18 a week. Mm-hmm. And the good earners were $50 to $75 per week, you know, for labor.
So the demon spirits looked on you so favorably, they began to help you win, mm-hmm, in your gambling.
Then I went to other bookies, you see. And one day, I am told of the man at the cage, where you do your bet. He says, my boss would like to talk to you. And he said, you go right through that door over there. Oh, sure. So I know the guy says, come on in. The guy's sitting behind a big desk, smoking the big cigar. So he says, you're Roger. I says, yeah. He got up and walked around me. He said, you don't look that smart. I said, what, sir? You don't look that smart. He said that you could pick horses that are winners when they're supposed to be losers. Where do you get your help? What do you mean help? I'm not getting any help. I just happened to go in. Oh, no. We've been watching you here, he says, for a number of weeks. And you always leave here with some of our good money. And I'll tell you, buddy, if you want a list of all the bookies in Montreal, I'll give you a list of them. But he says, I want you out of here. And don't show up again. Because somebody's going to put a... You know what I mean? I said, okay, sir, I won't be back again. So it's a tough business, being gambling.
So even with the spirit's help, it was tough.
Yeah. Well, the stuff is going to shoot you, yes.
Yeah. The high priest would say a number of things to you when you were in these praise services, and you went to a number of them over a period of time. Mm-hmm. Talked about the issues of the great conflict. You've already touched on that a little bit. I want you to follow up on that a little bit more, Roger. Some of the things that you wrote in your book, Trip into the Supernatural, sounds a whole lot like what we as Christians today know as the Great Controversy. Mm-hmm. What were some of the things that he told you there?
Well, he says that there is a great controversy going between the force of good and evil, between Christ and Satan. And he always praised the great master, Satan, as a super intelligent being that he is, beautiful to behold, and if he ever appears to you, you won't be able to look upon him because he'll be too bright. He'll just ruin your vision. The high priest said he was in Chicago, and the spirit appeared to him and said, morneau and his buddy, George has invited them to the service, and the fellow that is in charge while you're away says that he's going to wreck all the work that the spirits have done for the last few years to get these people into the society. So the high priest, which is in Chicago, picks up the phone and calls, and the spirit appeared to him, and he said the angel was so bright that he could not look upon him. And he says after he picked up the phone to dial, he couldn't dial the phone because of the fact that his vision was so terribly blurred by the light, the beautiful light of the bright being. And he asked, dial zero, and the operator came on, and she had to, you know, dial for him. And they talk about many, many things in regards to, you know, who's going to win this conflict.
Any discussion about fire and brimstone?
Yes. He says, the Bible people, talking about the Christians, you know, they read in the Bible that, you know, we're all going to land in a lake of fire and this and that. So that's baloney. He says, the conflict is going to end peacefully. Christ is going to realize that you might as well abdicate the rights of this planet, take his few people on with him to his planet in the center of the galaxies, and we will be left with a master who will resurrect all his people that will be as numerous as the sand of the sea. See? And the master will rule forever and ever and ever. A happy people. And he named some of the people that's going to be there. I don't want to mention the names because they're known to history. Yeah. So that was quite impressive.
Did you always feel, Roger, that these people were telling the truth?
Oh, yes. Yeah. Yeah, they really had things down straight. But I was not satisfied with the answers. And there was something, and I understand now it was the Spirit of God saying, hold back, fellow, hold back. And the priest had thought about us thinking seriously about being initiated into the
cult. The rite. So they let you come to sort of take a look, see, but you can't go back for several months.
Oh yeah, it's not a matter of whether you're going to be initiated or not.
It's when.
You see.
So they begin to press you for a commitment.
So the priest said, "Look, fellas, I'm not going to pressure you into anything, okay? But I want to show you what the spirits can do for a devoted servant." We went downstairs, not through the staircase that I talked for the worship room of the gods, but at the other end of the building. Went downstairs, and a number of times I'd gone there to the men's room, and I heard these typewriters clicking like the dickens. Man, it's going. I said, "Why do we have a lot of people typing in there, in that room?" Well, we went there that Eve Dickens did. He knocked, and the man says, "Come on in." And there was all those typewriters moving along by themselves, typing at the speed that I'd never seen before. And not only that, the high priest says, "I want to show you something clever." So he says, "Follow me." So we went around a table that was like two long tables, and they had about 10 typewriters. And he says, "Now notice that the typewriter types to the right, then doesn't go back. It types back to the left. Isn't that something?" I had never heard of things like that before. He said, "The spirits are doing the work." And he introduced us to the man. And the man is a lawyer. And he said, "How much money did you make last year?" Oh, he says, "Send us six figures." You see?
So this lawyer had a business in the building that housed the worship room.
Oh, yeah.
And he had a whole room full of typewriters.
Yeah.
And he put paper in there, and demons
typed.
That's
all he did, put typewriter paper in there. And
what came out? What was it that came out?
Different briefs for court cases.
And so he would sell these to people?
He had the service to the legal profession.
And the high priest was
showing... The United States and Canada.
So the high priest was showing you this to give you an idea about the kinds of blessings that you would
receive.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But after you left that typewriter, the room where the lawyer was, they tried to draw you into a commitment by getting you to make a public profession.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Tell us about that.
Well, they have a super beautiful resort in the Laurentian Mountains, which is north of Montreal. North of Saint Agathe. Saint Agathe is a famous name there in Montreal, Montrealers, because they all go Saint Agathe or north there, you know, to summer home and that. So they had a big resort up there for their people, you know, so it's a close society. And they had on October the 30th, Halloween, is that?
October 31.
Last day of October. They had what they call live animal sacrifices. I don't know what it is that they did. We could never find out. By the time that the Lord pulled me out of there, I had not yet found out what it was. So you have this intrigue involved in there. And you talked about three very unique services that I attended there that sit on my mind forever. One was entitled Christian Idolatry. Another one was entitled The Super Deception of a Glorious New Age, which actually applies to the New Age today. And this was 1946, we're talking. And then the other one was Satan's Great General Council of the 1700s. And I must say, the things that I heard there was an eye-opener. First of all, we'll go through the Great General Council. At the beginning of the 1700s, said the high priest, Satan and all his spirit counselors held a great general council with one purpose in mind. It was to prepare for the great industrial age that was soon to break upon the world. And Lucifer also foresaw another age that was to follow that, where tremendous scientific discoveries would be made by people. And we would enter a unique age that would change the way that everybody lives. It would also serve to usher in the end times and the close of the great controversy between the forces of good and evil. And the priest said that Lucifer had been studying the Bible. And he found in Daniel 12:4, where we are told about the time of the end, many shall run to and fro, knowledge shall be increased. Mm-hmm. He understood it to be that we're getting to that point. And he had, with all the spirit counselors, to change their modes of operation in order, you know, to ensnare people.
Mm-hmm.
And to devise a way whereby people would disqualify themselves from being members of Christ's kingdom.
And he was just very candid about this.
Oh, yeah.
Telling mm-hmm. you and yeah. the rest of the group, 60 or 70 people there,
yeah.
the plans that
yeah, 100 people.
Lucifer had revealed to him.
Mm-hmm. And by the time the council came to a close, they had three major policies that were going to be followed. First, they were to see to it that humans would be made to believe that Satan and his angels do not really exist. Because see, up to that time, you could walk down a street of Paris and you would have signs that would say where you have a soothsayer or, you know, or a fortune teller of some type, and if you want to put a curse on someone, you could go and see this other old lady over there, you know, the old witch, that's the way it goes. But now it had to change. Lucifer says, we have to make sure that people, humans, get to believe that Satan and his angels do not really exist.
You know, Roger, that's interesting because a recent research study report that I read indicated that in a national survey, I believe it's over 75% of people mm-hmm. do not really believe in a real tangible devil. Mm-hmm. But there is one.
Oh, yeah. Now, the next thing, the three parts policy that they had adopted there, the second one was to find a way of being able to get total control of people's minds. And that would be done by taking hypnotism out of the realm of the occult and introduce it as a new science for the benefit of mankind.
So part of what the high priest told you was Satan's strategy to take total control of people's minds.
Mm-hmm. They felt that by taking hypnotism out of the realm of the occult and introducing it as a new science for the benefit of mankind, they could then use people of great renown, educators, people of capacity, that would do great things, such as supposedly regress people in time to former lives that they had. Mm. And of course, after the session is over, the person would not know a thing about ancient history, and the person that she or he has talked about performing, you know, certain deeds, we'll say 3,000-4,000 years ago. But this was their strategy. Now, what this would do for the thing is this, that it would create in the minds of the general public, solidly set in the mind of the general public, an unwavering trust in that great deception. In other words, people could, you know, they would believe it. This person as was hypnotized, was regressing time to, you know, former lives, and did this and did that, and no deception. Maybe Alexander the Great, we could say, you know, and some of the generals and people like that. And the person after the session is over, you know, comes out of hypnotism, and he or she doesn't know what she's talking about. So now this would be a way of de-Christianizing the Western world through the avenue of mysticism. Mm. Now the time came when Lucifer decided that he had to choose a person to initiate this thing. And Franz Mesmer, which was an Austrian physician, was chosen.
Because and the priest told you all of this.
Oh yeah.
Okay.
Because he was most capable. Mesmer originated a theory called animal magnetism. Later on named mesmerism. Mesmer was led by the spirits to believe, and this is what the priest said, was led by the spirits to believe that certain persons have a magnetic influence within themselves, so to speak, that would cause them to have great power over other persons even to the point of placing them into a trance. And at that time, that was readily accepted by people in general, at the time that Mesmer lived. So people realized, you know, this is, some people have got the capacity to put you into a trance. That's the way. Now, by the time that he died, in 1815, a lot of the physicians in Europe were using hypnotism as a means of anesthesia.
Now, hypnotism is the same as mesmerism?
That's right. Okay. So mesmerism that's been developed to a higher degree of refinement. And the priest went on saying that the plan of Satan to deceive the human family this way, he says it's the most intriguing thing to his mind. And he went on saying how it was going to be brought about. He said that a fellow by the name of Darwin and another fellow by the name of Thomas Henry Huxley would be used by the spirits because in their childhood they had been hypnotized by medical doctors. And they figured that they would be real good subjects to lead the people into this belief that they had, that Satan wanted to bring into people's lives.
Now, what were those 3 points again, Roger? The three things were, number one, that they did not want Satan did not want the human family to think that he or his angels existed.
Right.
The second point that you made had to do with taking control of people's minds.
That's right.
The third point was what?
Was to destroy the Bible without burning it.
Okay.
See?
And what was the strategy on that?
On that, it was very interesting. Because after the Great General Council, it was decided that Satan would tutor Charles Darwin personally in setting up the principles of his theories of evolution. He was tutored by Lucifer himself, fallen Lucifer. And at that time, it was understood, Satan and his spirit counselors understood, that if a person was led to believe in the theory of evolution, it would, in his life, destroy completely the creation week of the Bible, the fall of man, and the plan of redemption. It would do away with it.
In one fell swoop.
Yeah. Now, he made a unique statement. He said that according to the spirits, anyone that teaches a theory of evolution is considered to be a minister of a great religious system. See, they call it the religious system, the theory of evolution, because it is a system of schooling people and getting them to disqualify themselves and being members of Christ's kingdom. And he said that every teacher of that theory is recognized by the spirits as a person of great value, and receives a very special unction from Satan himself, giving great power to induce spiritual blindness, to convince and convert. Three capacities are given to those teachers of the theory. Then, that's not all. The priest says that Satan considers the teachers of the theory of evolution to be so valuable to him that in the sight of all the inhabitants of the galaxies, he assigns a retinue of bright, beautiful angels to follow that educator all the remainder of his life. And that in the sight of the inhabitants of the galaxies is the greatest honor that he can bestow upon his workers, upon mankind, and to, until the controversy is finished. That was quite enlightening.
Now, the high priest was talking just sort of like a preacher would talk up front. Was he enthusiastic? Did he seem like he had bought into this and was excited about it?
Oh yeah, he believed it 100%, no question about it, everything.
Why would he be so excited about spirits trying to deceive human beings? Because obviously out of this council of the 1700s, deception was a major part of the strategy. Why?
Well, he says it's deception. It's like politics. You know, you believe in one candidate, the other person believe in the other candidate, and they're fighting to get you know, the position, and it's just a matter of who's gonna be the smartest. And with Lucifer, the fallen cherubim, he's very smart. He's gonna win, and Christ's gonna abdicate the rights of the planet. He's gonna resurrect his people, have established his kingdom that lasts for ever and ever. God won't be able to destroy him because it would be against God's, the Creator's nature to destroy Lucifer in the fire. Beside that, he said, spirits now, even spirits, have the capacity now to outlive fire. He says, you don't believe it? Go to India or some of those countries where they have firewalkers. And it's done by the power of demon spirits. These people are energized by demon spirits, so they can walk on those hot coals without burning themselves.
And this is what the high priest said.
And he says, if they want to use fire, they can use it. It's not going to burn anybody. So that's the way they believe.
This high priest was almost talking to your group in an evangelistic fervor.
Oh yeah, because he figures that he's going to be one of the higher ups in the great kingdom.
Okay. Now, of the group that was there that night, 60, 70 people, I think you've mentioned before.
Yeah, it varied.
How many of those were people who were hardcore members, and how many of them were new inductees?
Well, we were the only two youngsters,
you
there,
and,
so to speak.
You and your friend. And how old were you at that time, Roger?
I was about 20.
20 years old.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, 20 years
old. Did you have a feeling of awe over the fact that you had been chosen?
Yes, in a way. And then I got thinking about this. When am I going to have to pay the price? The cost. My parents had brought me up like this. If you get involved with evil, you're going to reap what you sowed. So you want to be upright in life. And if you associate with evildoers, they'll probably land you in jail or somewhere else that you wouldn't want to be. So there's always a price to be paid.
So you had that little something,
yeah,
maybe instilled by your mother,
yeah,
and father a long time ago that kept you from, yeah, making that full commitment.
Now, one of the things that really amazed me and shocked me and made me sick at heart is when the priests talk about Christian idolatry.
What is Christian idolatry? The priest mentioned that word.
Yeah.
Tell us what he said, Roger.
He said that Christian idolatry is the most grandiose or great deception that has ever been brought upon the human family, upon mankind. And he says, and he boasted, that demon spirits are continually defiling Christian churches through the avenue of necromancy, by using a form of spirit worship that involves hundreds of millions of Christians into idolatry without their being aware of it.
Now, what is necromancy? Describe define necromancy for me.
Their belief, popular belief of necromancy, is to conjure the spirits of the dead.
So that you can speak with someone who has died.
Right.
Like the seance that you originally went to,
mm-hmm,
was the practice of necromancy.
Yeah. Now, the priest says that the super deception is brought about in only one way, through the deceptive belief that man has an immortal soul that lives on after death. And he said that constitutes idolatry through necromancy. So he says there are hundreds of millions of Christians that are practicing idolatry while they think they're glorifying God. See?
Because they believe that the soul is immortal.
Yeah.
They may not be talking to the, yeah, supposed spirits of the dead.
Oh, yeah. Contrary to popular belief, necromancy does not consist of conjuring the spirits of the dead. The reason being that man is totally mortal and does not possess an immortal soul. So who are they talking to? He says the friendly demon spirits that have always found over the centuries great delight in impersonating in apparitions departed loved ones and persons of great renown.
Now, friendly demon spirits.
Friendly demon spirits.
Are there more than one kind of demon,
oh, yeah,
spirits, Roger?
Well, there's three main divisions, and then there's divisions within those divisions. You have the friendly demon spirits that seem to have the finesse and the refinement, and they're not upset about what happened when they were thrown out of heaven what I gather. Then you have the warriors. They like to bring misery and destruction in the lives of people. Then you have the oppressors. The oppressors are the real wicked spirits that hate God with all of their, the Creator with all of their might, you know. So he went on explaining. He says, now, necromancy is in reality a belief, a religious belief. People believe that the dead have entered into a higher state of existence than they had when they were alive. Also, that they are in a position and have the capacity to help the living here on earth. See? Then he said, he says, this is where things get really interesting. He said, according to the great master, a person does not have to supposedly call upon the spirits of the dead to receive help, you see, to be involved in necromancy. All he needs to do is to believe in life after death. Because he said, necromancy is the belief that man is human, as a human being, as a immortal soul. So anybody that believes that man has an immortal soul is involved in necromancy. It's that simple. That's the way he explained it.
Hmm. Yeah. So how does that constitute idolatry?
By people believing that they are either talking to the saints, you see, the spirits of the dead saints, or a dead relative, or a dead person of some type. And you take, for instance, like Loretta Lynn. She says on national television, and I have the data on it, that I heard it myself. She said that she was made successful in her singing career by a dear friend of hers, who was the same age as she, and died when she was 18 years of age. And Loretta was trying to get into the singing world, you know, but it would, she says, I had no success at all. Until one night I was sitting in bed reading a book, and she says, who walks right through the wall but my friend, the spirit of my friend? And she says, Loretta, I'm going to make you a very famous person in singing Western country music, and I will be with you all the time. Trust me. And she says, she had a big concert once, and she was coming down with this bad cold, and she thought that her voice was going to give. She talked to her spirit and felt that she was going to be helped. And she got on the stage, and she started to sing, and right in the middle of where she really needed the power, no power at all. And her spirit friend tapped her on the shoulder and said, and started to sing for her. She said, her voice went through me, the power.
Mm-hmm. And you saw this in a television documentary?
Yeah. This was, I believe, 1976 it took place. Now, the priest explained that when people believe in this business, they are actually opening themselves to be completely deceived by demon spirits, because it gives the demon spirits an opportunity to impersonate the dead, see, and for people to believe their lies. And the priest says that thrills the... First of all, it says it brings the great master the respect and the reverence that is due to his great name. And it makes all the other spirits exceedingly happy, because they are the ones that have worked to lead people to believe in life after death. See? And they rejoice also. And that's the extent of what
Christian idolatry is all about. Friendly spirits, just to digress for just a moment. You mentioned three different categories, and the friendly spirits are the ones that love to impersonate being a historian or something.
In your
experiences in the praise services or in the worship room or the other places where you were, any of the places you were, did you ever witness an event where necromancy or even something that would be popularly called channeling today took place, where you actually heard the voice of someone in response to someone's questions?
A number of times, but there was one time in particular that fascinated me, because it was unique in one way. The priest told us that there was a French historian that was affiliated with Montreal, University of Montreal, which is a French university in the English university is McGill. So the University of Montreal is the French university. And this man was from Paris, but he's affiliated with the university. And he wanted to have some details in regards to Napoleon Bonaparte and one of his generals. So, by the way, there are also, in other parts of the world, elite spirit worshippers like the group that we had in Montreal. And he mentioned there that, he said, you guys are fortunate when my friend and I went in, because you're right in time to see something very interesting. My friend there is having his devotions in the worship room of the gods, and he will use a trance medium to converse with certain demon spirits that will inform him in regards to ancient history about Napoleon. And sure enough, we went down there, and somebody came up and said he's ready to for the session, and we went down there, and he said he would need three people. You would need three people, but he wanted five people that volunteer to be the channel for the spirit. Okay, so it was three of them were chosen there, and he had to go back and sit down. And the man shook his head like a little bit like this, his eyes went glazed, and he stayed at it for a half hour. And the spirit spoke to him, said, I'm a spirit counselor, and what would you like to know? And he had a clipboard. The historian, and asked him some questions.
This historian was from Paris.
Yeah.
And he was wanting information.
Some detailed information
about Napoleon.
Napoleon Bonaparte and one of his generals.
And so he asked the questions of one of these human beings that was channeling.
Oh, yeah, the voice changed and everything. The voice changed of the person completely.
Okay. And it identified itself as a spirit guide.
Oh, yeah, spirit counselor, yeah.
Okay, a spirit counselor. And. Yeah. And then proceeded to tell him all the events that he was asking,
yes.
Answer his questions?
And there was a certain question that was asked, and the spirit counselor said, I will have Lord Remy and Lord Alphonse duplicate, in other words, the dialogue that had taken place.
Oh,
the two other men fulfilled what he was looking for. But the one thing that interests me is the mayor of Montreal, Cavalier Hood. During World War II, at the beginning of the war, he was very controversial when it regards to the war effort. He would tell the French-speaking boys not to go into the armed service, see? Because you're going to go and shed your blood for the British, you know? And we're their servants, so to speak, and all that, and he didn't want them to go into war. And they put him in prison. He was jailed for the length of the war. For this. Now, the man said, I would like to have you tell me to the spirit to give me part of the speech that was given by Cavalier Hood on these steps of the Montreal City Hall on a certain date. There are different versions of what has taken place, and you, Lord, would know the exact one.
Now, the mayor of Montreal was still alive.
Was still alive.
And this historian is asking what was actually said at a speech.
Yeah.
Okay.
The spirit counselor said, I'm sorry, I can't help you. All of my activities and my people have taken place in Europe. However, after my departure, our departure, other spirits will come and help you. And sure enough, the guy vibrated a little bit, and he's back, and he said, boy, how long? He said, 20 minutes have been used as a channel. So they, again, the spirit entered into him, and the spirit said that he was a spirit counselor that could give him the information that he was looking for. So, again, it was given verbally, and it was the voice of Cavalier Hood.
Now, how did you know that it was the voice?
Well, because of the fact, you see, I was a youngster in those days, just about ready to go into the army. And Cavalier, we used to listen to the radio We had no television in those days, so it was only radio and read newspaper. And all the speeches of coming in, made, and all of it was on the radio all the time. And in those days, they had no tape recorders, as we have now. So they would, coming in would have to go to the Canadian Broadcasting Studio, where they made a record, a real phonograph record. And then they played it over and over, you know, for the rest of the
day. So you listened to those as a teenager before you went into the Army. So you knew his voice.
So I knew his voice really good. So I said to George, he was sitting next to me, he said, "Isn't it amazing?" He said, "If you think that's amazing, wait," he says, "until the spirits impersonate one of the departed people that you know personally, like an uncle or a brother or a sister or something like that." He says, "That is unique." But that's the way it was. You are able to reproduce a voice, man, and just to perfection. The spirits are exceedingly proud of this. Because, and this also was right up my alley, the priest said that as the times on this planet gets more and more difficult, and calamities of all kinds are striking the planet more and more frequently, demon spirits are going to impress people with the importance of Sunday sacredness.
Roger, when I was a teenager back in the 1970s, I remember a song that came out talking about the age of Aquarius.
Mm-hmm.
And since then, we've seen the development of the New Age. And I wondered if back when you were involved in spirit worship, if they talked about New Age at all.
Oh, yes. It was a big thing that was coming up. One of the major deceptions of the last days. Mm. And the priest told us, we talked quite a while, and then he said, "Could I have a little bit more of your time? I want to tell you something very fascinating." He says, "The grand plane, the master's grand plane, for harvesting the nations, for harvesting the multitudes of the earth into his cause, just before the close of the great controversy between the forces of good and evil." So we continued, you know, after we expressed ourselves that we're deeply interested to know more about the activities of spirits. And he said, "It's going to be done in a unique manner. This grand plan is going to take people are going to eat the stuff." Because it says, spirits, demon spirits, will declare themselves to be inhabitants of far distant planets in the galaxies that are coming to warn the inhabitants of planet Earth of the impending destruction of the planet unless something seriously proper is done to avoid it. And he went on saying that they will claim to have out-of-body experiences. Are you familiar with out-of-body experiences?
Mm-hmm. I've read about
them. In other words, so a person's there's some persons are supposed to be able to, you know, they believe in their immortal soul.
Astral projection.
Yes, right. Goes in two different parts of the world and sees things and come back and then they write all about it. You know.
I've heard of that.
So, due to the fact that the millions of the earth people believe in having an immortal soul, it has to be readily accepted when the spirits will, through a trance medium, converse with influential people of the line, you see.
Now, what is a trance medium?
It's a channeler today.
What is known today as a channeler?
Channeler, yeah. Okay. Shirley MacLaine's experience of getting involved in spiritism and with the inhabitants of far distant planets in the galaxies, I taped the whole thing 3 hours.
And you were hearing the fulfillment of
exactly.
What this high priest had said 45 years ago.
Yeah, exactly. So he went on explaining about the fact that the spirits will show themselves willing to give valuable guidance that will not only help people avoid the destruction of the planet, but it would cause it to enter into a higher state of existence. For instance, he said the spirits will promise, and this is a big word, promise, that if their recommendations are followed carefully, they will usher in a glorious new age of peace and prosperity, and there'll be, there'll be no more wars, see? there'll be no more famines, there'll be no more people getting unhappy to one another. Neighbors will love neighbor, and social unrest will not take place no more. It'll be there'll be perfect happiness for 1,000 years. That's what the Spirit is going to promise.
And almost like the Garden of Eden created all over again.
And now we find that a lot of preachers are preaching the great age of glorious new age of victory, victory over wars, victory over social unrest, victory over famines, and victory over all kinds of...
And he used the words new age to describe what was coming.
It would be a glorious new age, yeah. And this is exactly what the movement is all about today. And he went on and said, as I said earlier, that as life on this planet becomes more and more difficult, and calamities will strike the planet more and more frequently, the spirits at that time are going to put all their effort to impress religious leaders, to bring before the masses of the earth the sacredness of Sunday. See? He will teach Sunday sacredness. And with the religious leaders looking forward to 1,000 years of perfect peace on earth, they will put all their effort into it. Then laws will be passed by governments. One person asked, what's going to happen about people that don't believe in the Spirit's recommendation? The priest says, that would be no problem at all. Laws will be passed by governments that will force people to go along with it regardless of whether they believe in it or not. And he says, the law enforcement officers will explain to people, make it clear that such a law is necessary to assure the well-being of all people. He says, the laws will be passed, no effort at all. And then he went on and he said about the fact that the venerable day of the sun, which in ages past was such an irritant to the Creator, all of these great nations and other nations, the smaller ones, were all involved in sun worship. And in those centuries, the Creator found that teaching of worship of the sun to be a terrible irritant. And he said, it is going again to take place, but not in worshiping the sun, in remembering Sunday to keep it holy. He made a statement I will never forget. He says, by the observance of the day upon which the master, Satan, has placed the unction of his authority and power, he receives homage, regardless of whom people claim to worship. Isn't that something? So, can you understand now why I had 28 Bible studies in 1 week and started to go to church on Sabbath? And I never missed since until I became sick.
The issue of a day of worship came up in that meeting. Mm-hmm. Was Sunday the only day mentioned?
Well, you see, the priest mentioned, yes, about the fact Satan has chosen Sunday as his day. The Creator has chosen the seventh day of the week. Lucifer has chosen to call his day the first day of the week, Sunday. And regardless of what people claim to worship, worshiping God, the Creator, by observing that day, that particular day, they are bringing homage and respect.
Now, at that time in your life, you were 20 years old or so. Mm-hmm. Had you ever heard of a Seventh-day Adventist?
Never in my life.
In that meeting...
They didn't talk about Seventh-day Adventist. They talked strictly about Adventist.
Well, they just talked... But they did. The word Adventist was mentioned.
The priest was telling us that necromancy, as I mentioned earlier, is the belief that the dead have entered into a higher state of existence, etc. And he says, for centuries, friendly demon spirits have worked diligently to establish and uphold in the religious convictions of all people the belief that man has an immortal soul. Then he boasted about the fact that the master was so smart and that he had deceived the whole world, even in this age of great scientific knowledge and understanding. Then one person put his hand up. Okay. Priest says, yeah, yes, we want to say something? He says, what about the Adventist? You can't count them to see regarding the state of the dead. And I got a question. What about, how come they can't be brought under the Great Deception? The priest said, you're right. I apologize, says here, I made a mistake. When I said that all the millions of people living on the face of this planet, everybody, you know, was honoring the Great Master. I forgot the Adventists. They're so few in number when you figure the billions and all people, I didn't even think of mentioning them. So I'm sorry. Then he says, secondly, the reason why they can't be brought under the Great Deception, let me explain about it. Now he said, my next statement is going to upset some of you. But what I'm telling you is the honest truth. It is factual. It's reality. The fact that the Adventists observe the biblical Sabbath of creation and reverence the Creator on that day, it makes it impossible for the spirits to deceive them. They are given very special help and great spiritual insight. And he said, under these conditions, they are not ordinary people. And that stayed with me, man, just like this. And when I heard the word Adventist, when Sarah told me later on, which we're going to cover later, I asked him, I said, what denomination do you belong to? He said, I'm a Seventh Adventist. What is that again? He said, I'm a Seventh Adventist. I said, is that the same thing as Adventist? Oh, yeah. He says, a lot of people call us the Adventists. They don't talk about the 70s. Same thing. Boy, I was interested.
I bet you were. Now,
I wanted to know what his Bible said.
Yeah, I bet you did. Because that was the one group that the under question only, the high priest of the demonic worship house, the thing that he had said to you was, this is the one group that can't be deceived.
That's right.
And so somewhere back inside that that resistance you had came out and you awoke.
A few months later, that experience, unique experience, was instrumental in helping me make a decision for Christ. And also, I had no hesitation to join myself to God's commandment keeping people because of the fact that I knew what kind of people they were. And after having had 28 Bible studies in 1 week, I started to keep the Sabbath, kept forever. But you see, the time that I had these Bible studies, 4 hours per evening, we started at 7 o'clock and finished at 11 o'clock at night. We had this Bible study similar to what you have, what you showed me the other day, that you have in your pocket. The Bible studies were about an hour. There were questions, and then you looked up the verses that they gave you in the Bible, and you had your answer. It was so fantastic. And the Spirit of God was really ministering to me the graces of redemption. Every moment of all those Bible studies was precious. Precious, precious, precious.
Roger, at that time, your major language was French. You did not speak English, and all of this happened in the French language in Montreal. How long after you became a Seventh-day Adventist, or after you learned of Seventh-day Adventists, did you read the book Great Controversy by Ellen White?
Well, I joined the church. I first had a Bible study in October of 46. In April of 47, I was baptized into the church. In September of that year, Ildo and I got married. And the French church in Montreal gave us, as a wedding gift, the Conflict of the Ages series. And I had not read the Greek Controversy up to then.
But then you read it.
Oh, yeah.
And what went through your mind when you read the book Great Controversy, thinking back on the experience you'd had maybe just a year or so before?
That's right.
What went through your mind?
This person is inspired. This person has got knowledge that nobody else has on the face of the earth except, you know, the spiritist that I was mentioning because it's so unique.
Well, I find it very remarkable that they were willing to share the strategy that Satan is working on with this group. Of course, their plan was that it would never get out.
That's right.
Under seal of death.
That's right. Their plan is that you don't have to worry about saying anything about the Great Master. Because as soon as anybody strays some, the spirits will tell the high priest right away it's taking place. They did with my Bible study that Wednesday night. I studied on Monday and Tuesday. By Wednesday night, spirit counselor appeared to the high priest and says, you have one of your defectors. He says, that morneau guy, you're going to get rid of him. Because he's out there studying the Bible with the Adventists, the people that the master hates most on the face of the earth. And the high priest almost had a heart attack. Because he said, I kind of like you. He said, that's what he told my friend. Because I didn't see him after that. He told my friend to try to convince me to go back, you know, to spirit worship. You know.
Roger, you were 72 hours away from making a full commitment to the elite spirit worship. Mm-hmm. How did God rescue you at that strategic moment?
Well, I'll tell you, I should really go back a couple of weeks in time. As the high priest had talked to us about the advantage of getting initiated in the society on the 31st of October, that night I came home, went to bed, and I couldn't sleep till about 3 o'clock in the morning. Because I had all of this experience of the supernatural that I'd gone through for so many months now, and my Catholic upbringing that I've had, you know, and questions about God. Now I knew there's a God, because the Spiritist made me well aware of that. But I was in a state of terrible unrest. I could not have slept. And without even giving it a thought, somehow, I said, as I was laying on my bed, I said, if there's a God up there that cares for me, help me. That's all I said. Next thing I knew, the alarm clock rang. It was 6:30. It was time for me to get up and go to work. At that time, I had changed employment. I had taken a course in embroidery for the manufacturers of ladies' dresses in Montreal. There's an embroidery company that makes all this, the piping and sequins work and all of this, you know,
fancy
designs,
sure,
ladies' dresses. And that's where I was working at the time.
You were just 72 hours away, as Karen mentioned a moment ago. You had prayed, without even realizing what you were doing, God was about to rescue you in a very special way. Tell us about that. What happened that Monday morning?
Well, let's go back to the Friday.
Okay.
Previous to that, I was working for a Jewish firm, and the bosses, one kept the Sabbath and the other didn't. And Harry, which was the one that didn't, as I was going out to have my cigarette at the afternoon break, he said, Roger, when you come back in, come into my office, I want to talk to you. I said, okay. I came back in and he said, close the door. I closed the door. He said, I want you to do me a favor. Oh? What do you mean? Well, I'll tell you what. He said, did you notice yesterday or a couple of days ago, there was a fellow here that I showed around the shop? And, I said, yes. Well, he's going to be starting to work here Monday. And he's not just an average guy. He's a Christian, but keeps the Bible Sabbath. I said, go over that again? He said, yes, like the Jewish people, he keeps the seven-day Sabbath. Saturday is the seventh day of the week. Well, I said, let me tell you, sir, the nuns have told us that there's been a mistake made in the calendar, that actually what chose to be Sunday is the seventh day of the week. Oh, no, he says, there wasn't no mistake made in the calendar, he says. Saturday is the seventh day of the week, that you see it on your calendar. And he says, it never was changed. And Sunday is the first day of the week. Oh, and I said, that's interesting. I said, I'm going to have to go to the library and check this out. Oh, you don't have to, he says. He pulls out his desk drawer open, pulls out his big dictionary, and he looks up Saturday, and he said, the seventh day of the week. And looked at it on Sunday, and he said, the first day of the week. Okay. Well, I said, that's pretty interesting. Now, here's what I'd like you to do for me. I'd like you to, first of all, I'm going to have this man work next to you, on the machine next to you. And don't tell him that I want to know what denomination he belongs to. You've got to be very tactful. You have all the time in the world, even if it takes a month, he says. I tell you what, he says, it's the craziest thing, he says, that I've been thinking about this guy and I can't get him out of my mind. about this, the fact he's a Christian and keeps the Seventh-day Sabbath, keeps the Bible Sabbath. And he said, you know, I've got more important things to think about than stuff like that. So he said, I want to find out what denomination he belongs to. And I just did. I said, why didn't you ask him? Well, he said, no, I wouldn't do that. That's too personal. Okay.
So he wanted you to ask him and find out for him.
Find out and not let him know that, you know, the boss was interested, you know. So Monday morning came, and the new fellow came in, and the boss introduced him to the people. There was about maybe 50 people working in that plant. And he said, Cyril's an accomplished embroiderer. We'll be very happy to have him here with us, and, you know, made a little speech. Then he walked him to his new machine, and he says, Roger, meet Cyril, and I shook his hand, and we started to work. And it was not more than about 20 minutes that I was working that my machine started to skip stitches. So what happened? You have to stop and back up where you were. And you, I was working on sequence. In other words, the sequence come up, there's a row of thread behind it. It's all on they're all set up, and it's on a spool. And then the needles put them in there. And it, when it skips, you got to stop, back up, start over it from where it left off. It wasn't too long that I'd done this two or three times.
And that really made you happy, I bet.
Man, I was mad. And as a French person, usually they don't go easy on the saints and gods. That was using some language was not that great for Cyril. But anyway, I called the boss over. I said, come and see this machine, I'm having trouble with it. He checked it, worked on it for 5 minutes, you know, work with it. Beautiful. I sit down again, start to work, the same thing happens over again. Harry, after he tried that two, three times, he said, Joe, come over. He's the old guy that knows everything about everything, you know, in the shop. So he looks at the tensions and just his things, and he says, it's working beautiful. Well, I started to work again, another 20 minutes after, same thing, and I had to stop the whole thing. By then, you know, it was time to go out for the coffee break.
Cyril and Cynthia, so good to have you folks come down and visit with us for a short time today. And Cyril, I want to start off our visit by just asking you about an experience you had, I believe, almost 45 years ago.
That's right.
You had gone to work at a new embroidery shop in Montreal, Canada. And there was a guy that was at the next machine to you that first day you went there. Did you notice anything strange about him?
Yes, I did notice he had some peculiarities that, well, to say the least, they were different. First of all, when he worked at his machine, when he had a little malfunction, he knew how to, well, criticize the machine by using some language that was quite offensive, to me at least. He would curse at the machine, and in both French and English. He was quite a linguist. And when my machine would break, he noticed that I would just fix it and keep on working. There was a difference, and he noticed the difference himself. We were both behaving differently when our machines didn't function right.
Now, so that very first day, there were problems with the machines. Your machine and his machine
right.
had problems.
They both had problems.
But you had a chance at the break time to get acquainted with him. And how did he approach you?
Well, he approached me with a question, sort of. He said, I noticed that when your machine gives trouble, you don't get angry. You just fix it and keep on working. And I told him, well, it didn't make sense to get angry with the machine. It's an inanimate object. And he sort of apologized for his getting angry with his machine. And we started a conversation there. And it gave me the opportunity to sort of introduce him to some of the things I had experienced just a few days before.
And what were the things that you had just experienced a few days before?
I was getting some Bible studies from a minister named Elder Warren Taylor. And although I wasn't an Adventist, I was quite moved by those Bible studies because of the fact that as he gave the Bible studies, he kept it quite simple. And he would prove everything he would say, even if it's from the Bible, he would prove it. And in some cases, he proved it from worldly books such as the Encyclopedia Britannica. And he gave good evidence of everything that he was saying was true.
So I started walking out, and I told Sarah, I said, have you ever seen such a crazy thing as this, the trouble that I have with this machine? No, he said, it's a new machine. I said, brand new machine, just a month old. He said, that's very unusual. So we go downstairs, and I said, do you have any suggestions how to fix this problem? No, not really, but he says, I have a suggestion that might help. He says, I heard you, he says, calling upon God, but it was not in the way that I would have liked to hear you talk. He says, go easy on God, he says.
Did that offend you, Roger?
Yeah, you know, I said, thank you. It did not offend me, because he was pleasant about it. And I said, you know, I said, thank you. I said, I'm sorry if I offended you by my language. He says, it didn't bother me. I said, by the way, I said, this is the opening. You're quite a religious man, I understand. Yeah, he says, I read the Bible and go to church. That's great. I said, what denomination do you belong to? Well, I'm a Seventh-day Adventist. Excuse me? Repeat that again. He says, yeah, I'm a Seventh-day Adventist.
Did that shock you?
Well, the word Adventist shocked me. The Adventist, you see, I had heard so much about the Adventist, but Seventh-day Adventist, I had never heard the name before. I said, what does it signify, the name? He says, well, we're Seventh-day observers. We believe in the Bible Sabbath, that God has blessed a particular day of the week and has sanctified it. It's put a special blessing on there, and that we ought to count our blessings on the seventh day and, you know, give God the honor that is due to his holy name. Is that any difference between what they call, some people call the Adventists and Seventh Adventists? Oh, no, it's just the same people. Most people just talk about the Adventists, and they know people know that they're talking about the Seventh Adventists.
Then your interest was really piqued.
Now I said, man, what a unique thing to have happened to me, that I meet one of these guys.
You're together out there at your first break time, mm-hmm. and you're discussing the language on the job when the machines had broken down, but you had an opportunity to begin to share some of this newfound faith that you'd been discovering.
Right.
Did you find him to be interested, open?
Well, what really happened was he would ask questions, and I found out later that the reason he asked questions was when I went to get the job, I was so impressed with Elder Taylor's Bible studies that I told the employer right away that I didn't work on the Sabbath. He said, well, that's all right, you don't have to work on Sunday at all. I said, no, Saturday. So being a Jew, he became rather interested. And he told Roger, and Roger told me later on, check this fellow and find out why he keeps my Jewish Sabbath. So Roger's questions were motivated by the fact that he was told to check. And the more questions Roger would ask, the more interested he became himself. So as he became more interested, and I told him more, he suddenly said, I want to hear more about your religion. And I said, okay, this weekend. He said, no, tonight.
So we talked about a number of things. And after lunch, I told him, I said, I want to see you at 3 o'clock. Again, I want to have another question for you. So 3 o'clock came along, we had the coffee break, and many things had passed through my mind. And I knew that if I get involved with the religion, the spirit is going to destroy me. So I've been assured, we've all been assured of that. You don't deviate from the will of the spirits, otherwise
you're
nothing, your history. So I told him, I said, Cyril, would you show me out of the Bible the things you told me today, if I went to your house? He says, yeah. Yeah, he says, yeah, I'd be glad to. He says, when, next week sometime? No, not next week, tonight.
Did he look surprised when you said that?
Yeah, he's surprised. He said, what's the big hurry? I said, I can't tell you why, but it has to be tonight or never. He said, you serious? I said, yeah. And you can't tell me why it has to be tonight? I'll tell you the reason why. He says, I would like to have you come in another night, because I have my collection of jazz records that somebody's coming to look over. He had been collecting jazz records for years. And he said, I have somebody's interested to buy them. But he said, well, I said, well, forget about it then. And he said, man, He said, you really mean what you say? That you want to see these things in the Bible? I said, sure. Okay, he says, come to my place 7 o'clock tonight. Give me his address. So that evening, 7 o'clock, sharp, I rang the doorbell.
Did that startle you?
It startled me because it was fortunate I had 28 Bible studies for busy people, something I just bought. And I ran home, Cynthia and I were married at this time. And I ran home and I told Cynthia, we have to give some Bible studies because this fellow's coming tonight. So I went through the first couple of Bible studies as quickly as I could and got myself familiarized with them. And we got all ready and sure enough he came. And we sat in that room, the room that we talked about that burned, mm-hmm. and we started those Bible studies. And he was very interested.
Cynthia, that mm-hmm. first night that you had your Bible studies with Roger, how many studies did you actually do with him?
We did 4.
On the first night?
On the first night. We started promptly at 7, and as we went through, and we went through with everything in detail, in full detail, and we thought that, oh, this is just going to last the evening, and that would be the end of it. And then he said, no, he says, let's do the next one. So each one, so we didn't finish until about 11:30 or 11:45. And when we finished, he'd sit around and talk. By the way, he was a chain smoker. The room was covered with smoke. We could hardly see the Bibles in our laps. And we had discussed this prior about him smoking. And so we decided, we prayed about it, and we asked the Lord that even though each time he came, the room was just full of smoke, that we will read his word and that he will take care of the smoke. And I happened to be allergic to cigarette smoke, and we were all huddled together. It was really something to see us.
28 Bible studies in a period of 1 week, 7 days.
7 days, 4 hours a night.
4 hours per evening, yeah.
28 Bible studies.
Now, they didn't plan this. So, as we chatted, and I just met Cynthia, now, Cheryl told me, I got to explain things to you a little bit. I am not a baptized member of the Seventh Adventist Church. I'm just studying into the church doctrines with the minister. Says, my wife is a Seventh Adventist. But he said, now I think I'm going to be baptized also be a Seventh Adventist. But I said, I'm not one right now. Now he says, my wife is the one that really knows the Bible. I don't know much about it. And I think that she's got the right study for us tonight. He says, it'll take about an hour. Can you spare that much time? Oh, I said, evening is yours. Well, she had a set of Bible studies that were entitled 28 Bible Studies for Busy People. That was the title of the series. She pulled one out and she said, now, we could see here, there's different questions. The first one was on the Word of God. And she read the question and said, then we can find the verses in the Bible that gives us the answer. And the next question, she said, would you like that? I said, beautiful, let's go. So Sarah was sitting next to me with his Bible because he was able to find where it was. I had never opened a Bible in my life, never. So, because I never had access to it, let's put it this way. And that's where it started, on the Word of God. After the Bible thing was over, he says, well, did you find it interesting? I said, most interesting, very interesting. I said, what's the next study coming up? Well, he said, the next study, oh, Daniel 2, Prophecy of Daniel the Prophet 2, on the world events, you know, predicting the different great world empires that were to come into existence in times ahead. And I said, really? That's very interesting. I said, how long would that one take? Oh, she'll take about an hour. She said, yeah, between 20 to 25 questions, says, you know. So I said, let's have it now. Oh, well, she said, no. I said, when could you come back? I said, why come back?
Did she look surprised?
She looks very surprised because she looked at her husband. And you look at me. I said, hey, you guys like the Bible or are you getting tired? No, we like to study the Bible. I said, let's have another Bible study. It's only 8 o'clock, you see?
And at that time, you were a smoker, weren't you?
Oh, a smoker. You can't say that again. I was like a chain smoker, you see. And when I had accomplished something worthwhile, I used to reward myself with a cigar 2 or 3 times a week. And this is what the love of God, the power of the love of God operates in the lives of those that the Lord is trying to bless. And it lies at those that are bringing the blessing. Now, this did not take place. First of all, we kept on studying. We had 4 Bible studies that evening. And when it came to 9 o'clock, we had Daniel 2 over with. I said, "What's the next Bible study?" And she said, "Well, the one they're going to have, will you come on the weekend? Could you come on the weekend?" I said, "Yeah." I said, "I can't come on the weekend. What is the title of it? She gave me the title." I said, "Man, that's interesting. It's only 9 o'clock. Let's have it now." So Cyril looks at her, you know, with very surprised look on his face. And Cynthia, she looked at him. And I said, "What's going on between the two of you? It's like you have a conspiracy that says that we're not going to study the Bible with this guy more than, you know, than an hour or two." But she said, "Let me be honest with you. Our minister, Pastor Taylor, has been giving us instruction on how to give Bible studies. Because Cynthia says, you know, I never have given Bible studies. And we really wanted to know how to give Bible studies to people that ask us the reason of the hope that is in us. And he's told us exactly how to do it. You have 1 Bible study per week. If the people are exceedingly interested, you could have 1 in the middle of the week, another one. But never more than that." And she says, "We've already passed our quota."
So the reason, Roger, for their hesitancy mm-hmm. was not the fact that you were blowing smoke in their face.
Oh, no, they
it was that. Because they were trying to follow the instructions that their pastor had given, mm-hmm. and you were asking them to break all those rules.
That's right.
Do you think they could sense your urgency?
Cyril and Cynthia told me later, yes. They said there's something very unusual about this man, Cynthia told her husband, because they went to get water, and to get me a glass of water, and she went in the kitchen to get something else, whatever it is, and she said, "What do you think of him?" And Cyril said, "There's something very unusual about this man." He said, "You want to study the Bible? Let's study the Bible. We won't tell about Elder Taylor. Let's not say a word to Elder Taylor. You know, we're going to ruin the whole thing.
Going to keep it a secret."
Because the minister had said, you know, you give people a spiritual indigestion, and they'll never want to open the Bible again. You got to say?
But this shows that there are some times when someone's yeah. appetite for it is right. so strong
yeah.
that you have to follow the leading of the Holy Spirit.
The Holy Spirit, yeah. That's it. And they had prayed about this thing. Now, Cyril had told his wife, "This man is coming for Bible study at 7 o'clock tonight for a Bible study. And he smokes. He's a smoke fiend. What are we going to do? Should we tell him not to smoke in our home?" He said, "If we do that, I'm afraid he's not going to stay for the Bible study."
What would have happened if they had asked you not to smoke?
I would have said, "I'm sorry. You're not my kind of people. You see, you're too reserved for me. I'm sorry." And still to this day, I thank God for the leading of the Holy Spirit that at that crucial time moved in there and inspired these people to say, you know, "Wouldn't you die, Cyril, for us, to save a soul for Christ?" Cynthia said to her husband. He said, "Yeah. It's not going to kill us, even if we inhale all the smoke that he puts out, right?" Because they had prayed about it, and then they had thought about it, and then when it came to be water for 7, he said, "What are we going to do about the smoking? Are we going to tell him not to smoke or what?" And then when she came out and she said, "You know, let's put up with it." Well, we had that 3rd Bible study. Now it's 10 o'clock. And I said, "By the way, what's the next title?" And she told me about it. And my goodness, this is a beautiful Bible study. I said, "Let's have it." And he said, "You know, really, Roger, we've studied too much tonight. You're never going to be able to remember these things." Oh, I said, "You'd be surprised. I got a mind like a sponge for the things that I like." He said, "You're enjoying yourself." I said, "Never heard anything like this in my life." seminar study. What time do you go? People go to bed. First of all, I don't want to, you know, infringe on your regular habits of resting yourself. And well, you said we go to bed 11 o'clock. Beautiful. I said, go on, Cynthia. And Cheryl says, go on, Cynthia. And we had another Bible study. Now the Bible studies are over. And I said to myself, if I'm still alive, I want to be here tomorrow night.
Did you seriously doubt whether you would be alive the following night?
I felt sure I was going to be killed, going to be destroyed in some kind of an accident. Because I've heard of so many cases. So I knew that I was not, this is the way I felt, I was not going to be alive tomorrow night. If for some reason I'm alive, I want to be back here with study the Bible with these people, see? So I said, what are you people doing tomorrow night? Not too much. What about 7 o'clock? Another Bible study. And she looked at her husband, and he looks at her, you know, he said, hey, we won't tell Elder Taylor. We won't tell him a word about it.
We'll just do it.
We'll just do it. He says, we'll be here at 7 o'clock tomorrow night waiting for you. The next night, man, I was there. Four more Bible studies, see, and more smoke.
This has been part one of A Trip into the Supernatural, an interview with best-selling author Roger Morneau, as conducted by Dan and Karen Houghton of Heart Research Center. The conclusion of this exclusive interview is contained in part two.
Footsteps walking down his hall. He lived at the end of a long hall, and his door was the only door down that hall. And the footsteps would stop at his door. Then a rap would come to the door. And at midnight, we heard the footsteps coming down the hall. I said, Roger, put your hand on the doorknob and get ready to pull it open. And so with all the bravado that I could muster with a gun, I waited for the rap on the door, and there it came.
Heart Research Center presents part two of A Trip into the Supernatural with best-selling author Roger Morneau. In part one of this exclusive interview, Roger Morneau told about his experiences with Satanism as a young man. Joining him again in part two are Cyril and Cynthia Grossi, who helped Roger break away from the power of darkness to discover a loving God. Conducting this interview are Dan and Karen Houghton of Heart Research Center. Let's now watch the conclusion of A Trip into the Supernatural.
We continued, and we continued to give him Bible studies with the smoke and all. And we got down to the Bible study where health, diet and health. And
body temple.
Body temple. And he was fascinated with that. And so we finally told him that, I think there's a text that when men turn away from God, they turn to the bitter weed.
Bitter herb.
Or herb or something. So we like the bitter herb to tobacco. Mm-hmm. So he was fascinated with it. And he says, well, why didn't you tell me that you didn't smoke?
I think what really got him was the, when he read, know ye not that your body is a temple of God, and if mm-hmm. any man defile a temple of God, him will God destroy. And so he asked me, what do you mean by that? So my reply was, well, let's take the church. We all respect the church. Would you take a cigarette into the church and smoke it? He said, of course not. Then I said, would you take alcohol into the church and drink it? He said, no, that would be silly. And so by making those comparisons, finally I said, your body is the church. Your body is the temple. He said, am I smoking? I said, right. He said, why didn't you tell me this on the first night? I said, if I had told you this on the first night, you wouldn't come the second night. He said, you know, that's right. So you can see where patience is a virtue. If you use patience and take your time, it pays off.
He told us that he realized he was getting into demon worship to the point where it was scaring him. He was frightened. And he prayed a prayer to God, even though he didn't realize it, and it wasn't with all the trappings that right. Christians usually use, but he said, if there is a God in heaven, help me. And at that time, you were an answer to his prayer.
That's right.
But also, wasn't he an answer to your prayer?
He certainly was. When Elder Taylor got to the point in his Bible studies of speaking about the Sabbath, all of my background, I was born in Halifax, Cynthia was born in Montreal. All of my background was Baptist and some Methodist. And I couldn't see going to church on Saturday instead of Sunday. In fact, I would laugh at my wife for quite some time, even as a child, that the fact that she was going to church on the wrong day. But getting back to the point is, when we were taking those Bible studies and Nella Taylor got to the Sabbath question, he proved it, yet I didn't believe it. And there's a point in your studying the Word of God that you want to stay with tradition rather than go with the truth. And I wanted to stay with tradition. But at the same time, the truth was pulling me back to the point where I said, I didn't even tell Cynthia this, Lord, if you want me to keep this Sabbath, let me, with the knowledge I have, win one soul. And if I do this, I know that it will be a sign. And not long afterward, I met Roger, sat down beside him, and he asked me for Bible studies. Mm-hmm. I know it was a sign. I'm here today.
What part did Cyril's conviction about the Sabbath truth play in you being confronted by Christ with these eternal realities? So I understand that he wasn't even a baptized Seventh-day Adventist. He was baptized the first Sabbath you went to church. But what if he had not been convicted of the Sabbath and had told your Jewish boss mm-hmm. that he would be willing to work on the Sabbath?
Well, I would lose out on eternity, I believe. I would have lost hope.
So his conviction
yeah.
was part of the process that Christ used to mm-hmm. confront you.
But there's more to this. He was working for a real nice firm, embroidery firm, and he was studying the Bible with Pastor Taylor, and Pastor Taylor had brought him now to the point where he said you should observe the seventh Sabbath if you're going to, you know, serve the Lord all the way. Serve the Lord, serve him all the way. The Lord says, if you love me, keep my commandments. The fourth commandment says, remember the Sabbath to keep it holy. And the Lord says, why he wants us to keep it holy? Because he's God and we're the creatures and that we ought to be counting our blessings, so to speak. Now, Cyril was pondering this thing in his mind, and he said to himself, and he prayed about it, Lord, I want some kind of a sign that you're really with me in this, that you want me to start keeping the seventh Sabbath now. But Lord, there's something missing. I tell you what, if you make it possible for me to meet someone that doesn't know about the Sabbath, because not too many people know about it anyway, and that I'm able to convince him of the importance of the biblical Sabbath of creation, then he says, I'll know that you want me to start giving a Sabbath now, instead of next year or some other time. And do you know that prayer was answered in 2 weeks? We figured out a time, about a time that I said, if there's a God in heaven that cares for me, help me. I think it's a couple of days after that he made a decision that, hey, Lord, show me. And I just love, would like to enjoy the experience of knowing that you're listening to me and that you're doing something special for me. And I'm doing something special for you because I'm obeying your commandment.
So in reality, Roger, you yeah. were an answer to his prayers
yeah.
before, while you were still a spiritist.
Mm-hmm.
Cyril, did you and Cynthia know at this time when you were studying with Roger that he was involved at all with spirit worship?
You know, the Lord blessed us mightily. He blessed us with the fact that we were completely ignorant of anything. And I would not advise anybody to openly go and do something like we did with having the knowledge that this person is a devil worshiper. because no person has the power to overcome this on their own. But I feel very impressed that the Lord, the Holy Spirit, guided us, and our eyes were covered until a certain time that we could handle it.
And when was that time, Cyril? When did you discover that this man worshipped demon spirits?
We discovered that midway between the lessons, and I don't know exactly what point it was, but one night he came, and we had previously studied on the unpardonable sin, and he came with tears in his eyes, and he was very upset, and he said, he said he was upset, and he had books on his arm, and I said, well, what are you so upset about, Roger? Roger in French. And he said, well, you don't know what I've been doing. So I said, look, the Bible says all manner of sins will be forgiven. And he said, but you don't know what I've done. So after he told me what he had been doing, worshiping the devil and getting acquainted with devil worship and going very deep into it, he showed me some books, and when I opened one of the books and read some instructions on how to worship the devil, I closed it up. I said, I don't want to see this. And I said, but one thing I want to make clear. I said, if you had committed the unpardonable sin, you would not be here willing to study the Bible. And therefore, the scripture that says all manner of sins will be forgiven applies to you. I said, you must consider yourself forgiven, and you must forgive yourself. And we went on from there.
I didn't even know what a devil worshiper was. I think we were both very naive. And so I went along, and I said, well, I tell you what, we'll leave the fact whether the sin is pardonable or unpardonable to God, and let's finish the Bible study. That was all of the information and knowledge that I had. And it wasn't until later. And then he began telling us, you know, a little bit about the troubles he was having. And I thought that was rather unusual, and we're being involved.
Now, Cyril, whenever you did learn, you and Cynthia, about this spiritism business, you immediately had a question about whether or not it was real. You were really naive about that. Now tell us, you had some special dispensation, some special work with the police department there in Canada, and you had the ability to carry a gun, is that right?
Yes, I had a permit to carry a gun. And when he told me that not only was he having these manifestations, he was also having, he heard footsteps walking down his hall. He lived at the end of a long hall, and his door was the only door down that hall. And the footsteps would stop at his door, then a rap would come to the door. And we were also having trouble with the union at that time. So when he told me about these rappings on the door, I said, no, that's only those union people trying to come and get you.
Yeah.
So I said, I'll scare them away just the same as I scared them away when they came to get me. And so I had so much faith in the gun that, don't forget, I wasn't baptized at this time.
That's right.
I had faith in this gun. So I took my gun and we went to Roche's place, and we were laughing and talking and just having a jolly time. And at midnight, we heard the footsteps coming down the hall. I said, Roger, put your hand on the doorknob and get ready to pull it open. And so with all the bravado that I could muster with a gun, I waited for the rap on the door, and there it came. And I don't know exactly how many times the rap came.
Well, first you opened the door, and there was nobody there.
Right.
And you said, now his color changed. The color of his face changed.
The color of his face changed?
Yeah,
believe it or not.
He wasn't expecting union people.
Yeah, there wasn't anybody there.
Was nobody there.
What was your emotion at that moment, Sarah? What did you when that door came open?
And there was nothing there.
Well, his emotion, excuse me for jumping in here,
okay,
was that he was almost like, you know, a statue of salt.
That was your observation,
yeah.
Roger.
That's right. So I said, hey, let's sit down, man. I said, you know, they're not going to harm us. So we sat down with Cyril, and we talked some more. There was no problem. And about 10 minutes later, the spirit knocked on my balcony door. And the glass was loose a little bit in there, and it rattled pretty bad.
And did he still have all the bravado?
By then, he jumped right out of his seat. Didn't you, Cyril? And he said, let's get out of here, you know, because he had knocked real hard.
Yeah. It was at that time I said, Roger, I think it's time for me to get rid of the gun. and get baptized.
Yeah, that's right. That made it make his decisions baptized.
Well, I've heard of lots of ways the decisions are made, but that's probably one of the most unique I've heard.
Dramatic, to say the least.
Yes.
We were like children dealing with something we had no knowledge about, and he protected us. And like I said, if anyone knows of someone who is involved in this, they can't do it alone.
Requires special prayer and protection.
And it requires the Lord to be the one to handle the situation. A man cannot handle the situation because the powers and principles that involved in this, no man can withstand.
What gave you the sense that you now had an opportunity for salvation? What was it that told you you had a chance?
Well, the Holy Spirit was inspiring me. The Holy Spirit was ministering to me the grace of redemption. And to be able to put it into words, I don't have this kind of a vocabulary, because it's a mystery type thing. The Holy Spirit recreates you as He ministers to you, you see? And cleans your mind and gives you understanding and you see things in a different light that you never thought about before. Life becomes a meaningful thing all of a sudden, and you'd be waiting to die for it, you see, for what you've learned. Because that's what I said to myself. The second night when I went back home, I had about an hour in the streetcar to my place. I got home at 12 o'clock. I said, hey, if they do me in tonight, I have the beautiful experience of having learned these great, wonderful things about God. Beautiful things. So on Wednesday night, there I had the first hope. I can't remember exactly what verse of scripture was, but this one here says, he came unto his own, and his own received him not. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God. You see, and you had to explain what it meant.
And you took that right into your heart.
Yeah.
Roger, during these 3 days, from Monday night, Tuesday night, to Wednesday night, what went through your mind regarding the spirits?
I knew that I was going to be worked over by the spirits, either through one of their boys or some accident or something, see. This is the way I felt, I mean. And I said, this is very unusual that nothing has happened yet. And I'm going home on Wednesday night again with another appointment for Thursday Bible studies at 7 o'clock.
Now, let me make sure I understand. You had missed Wednesday night's spirit praise service, at which time you were supposed to have made your full commitment.
Yeah, I would have.
And you had been at a Bible study instead.
That is correct.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so what happened next?
So I said, this will be the end of it. Wednesday night, I said, they'll have a praise session to the gods, and that'll be it. But nothing happens Wednesday night. Thursday morning I was alive. And I went back for another Bible study. And that is four more. And by then I realized that the Creator was taking care of things. Because these people never give God the glory. But they always refer to higher powers. They respect, they pride themselves on the fact that they respect authority. You see? So therefore, they recognize the Creator for who He is, but of course that the Master, fallen Lucifer, is just as smart as God is, and he's got it worked out. So he's going to have a kingdom to himself for eternity, and you know, you don't have to worry about things. So I realized that the power of God was intervening. Now I became a brave. See, and the Spirit of God gave me the strength to do that, because I said that God gave me the strength to be able to die for these things that I just learned. You see? And that's what happened. I got those Bible studies.
So you went ahead and went to a Bible studies on Friday night?
Yeah.
And then you kept your first Sabbath, didn't you? Tell us about your experience on Sabbath.
First, that evening, before I left, 11 o'clock, Cheryl says, you enjoy the Bible studies. Oh, yeah, very, very much so. I said, tomorrow you people are going to church. He says, yeah. I said, interesting. He said, would you like to come with us? I said, yeah. Because I had the Bible study on the Sabbath already. I said, sure. I'm still alive. And he said, what do you mean by you're still alive? Well, I said, you know, I said, well, I'm still alive. I'll be here. I'll do this. I'll do that. But I knew what I'd said. I'm still alive. And he said, would you join us here and we'll walk to church? It's not that far. We'll walk a few blocks and it'll be a nice day tomorrow. I said, yeah, sure, meet you here. And we walked to church and we were welcome at the door, and there was a rack of brochures on the walls. I walked over and looked at some of them, picked up a couple, put in my pocket. And we worked on Sabbath school, and I thought it was great.
Roger, the Lord helped you get through the Sabbath day without smoking. How did you eventually deal with your smoking habit?
Well, I tell you, Pastor Taylor talked, for quite a while. When it gets to be about 7:15 in the evening, I was getting very distressed because I got a tremendous urge of smoking about an hour before. And I said, oh, I got to have a cigarette. I just can't stand it anymore. And as the pastor continued explaining what I had to ask him to explain, it was difficult for me. And as you left, I told Cyril and Cindy, I said, I'm sorry, but I got to smoke. And on the way home in the streetcar, I said to myself, this is going to be, excuse the expression, but hell on earth to give up smoking. Then I said, no. It's not going to be, because I'm going to have help. I got to my apartment and I opened a closed closet and I had two cartons of cigarette on the shelf. And I opened them up and threw all the cigarettes, you know, all the packs were opened up, threw into the toilet and flushed it down the drain. And then I knelt by the little table that I had there with my Bible on it. And I had that already had started to read that Crucifixion of Christ, which I have read for 45 years now, every morning. Matthew the 27th chapter, verses 24 through 54. Every day, God willing, I always read it. Well, now I can have my devotions at night and I don't have to put the light on because I know it by heart, see? Mm-hmm. But there I placed my trust and my life in the care of the Lord of glory, who had shed his precious blood on Calvary to acquire the legal right to be able to redeem me from where I was and from where I was going. So that was the end of smoking. Never had a desire to smoke again. Mm-hmm. I told him to take the desire away to recreate me. I realized that he was a creator, he can recreate. Yeah.
Roger, as you came closer to making a full commitment to God, did the demons try to prevent you from making that commitment in any way?
Well, I didn't have to wait too long. During the week, the Spirit of God held back the demon spirits so that they could not have access to me. I realized that from Wednesday night on. Then, as I came home at midnight of that Saturday night, there was a note on my door from my buddy. And he said, it is urgent that I talk to you tonight. I don't care if you call me in the middle of the night. But he says, I got to talk to you. We're having a terrible disaster. Facing a terrible disaster. So, I said, well, Roland, one must have gotten some real static, you know. Sure enough. First of all, I wanted to review something that we'd studied at night. So I had a book. They lent me a book, Cynthia and Cyril, and I opened the book up and I started to read. And there was a marker, a sheet of paper actually, that had been cut in half in there. And I had put it on the table. And the piece of paper started to levitate and move around the room. See? So it didn't bother me. I knew what was doing it. And then the sheet of paper came and stood about a foot above my book. Then it was slammed down on the book. And the book fell on my lap. And almost into the floor, I picked it up. And I felt like telling the spirits, you know, buzz off. But I had understood that I would not again talk with spirits. I made up my mind on that. So I pick up the book again, started to write, and then the spirit picked up the book and threw it across the room against the wall with tremendous force. So I decided, well, I'm going to go and phone my buddy, see what he's going to do. Now, it was a public phone in the hallway. I didn't want to use it. I went down to a diner or restaurant or just down the block, and I called him up. How's things rolling? He says, man, he says, don't you care for my life, morneau? What kind of a friend are you? I've been suffering, he says, since Wednesday. He says, trying to get a hold of you. And he says, I've been waiting at your door. What time did you come home? I said, come home at midnight. He said, you're in real trouble. Because the high priest, as a spirit, appeared to him on Wednesday evening and told him that you were studying the Bible with some Christians. But you were not just studying the Bible with Christians. You were studying the Bible with Seventh-day Adventists, the people that the Master hates most on the face of the planet. How in the world did you get yourself involved in something like that? Don't you care for your life? I said, sure. Beside that, he says, and he told me other things that the spirits had told, the high priest. So the conversation went on the phone for a while, and I said, now listen. It's not possible for me to explain to you over the phone what has taken place in my studying the Bible 4 hours per evening, you know, through the week. Why don't you come to see me tomorrow sometime, and I'll give you the reasons, the real reasons why I did what I did. He said, okay. So we made an appointment for sometime Sunday morning. And I went back after my phone call, I went back to my apartment. And then I decided I might as well get to bed, slight. I get to bed. I was not sure in bed that the lights went on. I got up, went to the lights on. Get back to bed, the light goes on again. I said to myself, there's no use getting up, turning the lights off. They're going to put them back on again. So I'm going to decide to go to sleep with the lights on. So after a while, things start moving around the place. A picture on that wall goes and sticks itself on the wall. There's nothing to hold it up. And the light that was on the table moved and stands in midair. It stays there.
Were you feeling afraid at this time?
Oh, no, not at all. No, because of the fact that, human beings get accustomed to a lot of things. And you get supernatural strength, either from good or evil. Mm-hmm. And the Lord was singing me through this thing. And I knew that I was going to have a terrible struggle somewhere along the way, somehow. And they were going to try to destroy me, no question about it. So after this nonsense had gone quite a while, I went on to sleep. Hey, I'm going to get my rest. I'm tired. I said, Lord, you know, bless the old guy. I was not old in those days, though. But I said, bless the fellows. I can get some rest from these spirits. And I went to sleep. And it woke me up about 2 o'clock in the morning again. And at 4 o'clock. Now, at 4 o'clock in the morning there, I sat up in bed. Pushed my pillow in the back. And I said to myself, what in the world am I going to do? Because the Lord doesn't clear them out from me. Then I got a thought that maybe the Lord just wants me to know from the spirits exactly how things are, how I'm standing with them. And I said to the spirit, you want to talk to me? The spirit said, yes, finally, I'm able to talk to you. What in the world do you think you're doing? You see, the Lord had held back even on the spirits, that the spirits could not talk to me. I realized that they were under a very special control. So I got to talk with the spirit. And I realized that he was a spirit counselor. Because he said, the Master has tremendous plans for your life. fame, honor, respect, wealth. Don't you value any of these things? I said, I want you to know, Spirit, that 10 days ago, I would have grabbed your offer. But now you're talking to a former spirit worshiper, and I'm educated to the reality of life, especially of the reality of eternal life. And I said, I'm not interested. For about maybe 2 or 3 minutes, maybe 4 minutes, and it's a long time, in a conversation there was no response to what I had said.
It was like he was totally amazed by your courage.
Yeah. Then when the spirit spoke again, he had a tremor in his voice. In other words, you know when a person gets really desperate in a crisis situation, your voice changes. And it gave me the impression that he had a hard time expressing himself. And that was a very clever individual. Well, he said, we've worked for so long over the years to prepare you for the Master's work. And what are you doing? You know, and things like that. And he told me, okay, you're turning down the offer of the Master. I said, definitely. He said, from now on, he says, poverty would be the lot of your life. That is, he says, if you can manage to stay alive. And he says, that I doubt that you won't gonna have much of. He says, your days are numbered. I said, you know, Spirit, the high priest has mentioned about higher powers. Am I affiliated now with higher powers? And I said, I don't have to concern myself with you or your master or any of the other spirits, because you're all losers. I am the winner. 100 million years of perfect life, recreated, translated, or resurrected body that I'll have. My years will be counted into the millions of years. If I take the offer of the Master, what do I have? I'm 20 years of age. Add, even if I live to be 100, how can you compare that to 100 million years? And I'll have all the gold that I want and the silver that you're offering me, and more. So I'm not a loser no more. I'm a winner. And the spirit says, we'll destroy you. And he laughed. He had this was frightening. For one time, he had this laugh that caused me to think immediately of the laugh that Nero, instantly, Nero must have had on his face when the lions were tearing the Christians apart. That's the thing. I said, this is the way that Nero must have laughed when the lions were tearing Christians apart, you know, in the arena of the Colosseum in Rome. Yeah.
So how did the spirit finally leave, Roger?
They finally leave, almost took the door away with him. He left through the balcony door, and the door was slammed open. Yeah, open. And the doorknob almost went through the plaster in the wall.
Did he leave on his own accord?
I commanded him to. I commanded him in the name of the Lord Jesus to leave my place, come no more.
And he left?
And he left. And instead of slamming the door shut behind him, like a person would, he slammed the door open as he went out, and he slammed into the wall. And the doorknob, Cyril may still remember, you could see the imprint of the doorknob in the plaster. The house was maybe 50 years old, so the plaster had been settled a long time.
You commanded the demon to leave by the blood of Jesus Christ.
Yep.
He left, slammed the door. Did you go back to sleep?
Yeah.
And then the next morning, your friend Roland came over.
Well, between that, I'd like to tell you a little
bit
more. I woke up in the morning, of course, and I said, my, time to get up. And my Bible, my night table was to my left. As I was laying in bed, I put my hand on the Bible, and then I started to shuffle, you know, the pages like this. Mm-hmm. And I was thinking about many things, and I was doing this. And all of a sudden, I opened the Bible, wide open. And then I got thinking about it again, never realizing what I'd done. I got up, and after I stretched myself out a little bit, I look at the Bible, and my eyes fell on this Isaiah chapter by Isaiah the prophet, and I got reading, and it was the experience of Ezekiel when Sennacherib, the great general of the armies of the Assyrians, had compassed about the city of Jerusalem, and he was telling Ezekiel that he might as well give up, open the gates, you know, you're not going to survive this because we've destroyed all the nations that we've gone through before getting here. And I was very impressed. The fact that Ezekiel took the letter that the general had sent him, and he went in the temple of the Lord and placed it before the Lord, and he talked to the Lord about the letter. You see? And asked for his protecting care and guidance. And when he had not yet returned to his castle, when Isaiah came, the prophet, and he told, he says, the Lord has got a message for you. The way that Sennacherib has come, that's the way that he's going to return. And I love that prayer. That is a kind of prayer. I memorized that. It was a beautiful prayer. Because I got, from that moment on, I got an inner desire to fortify myself with the Word of God. Because every time that I read the verse in the Bible that applied to my condition, I received encouragement and strength. And I said, this is what I need to do. I'm going to fortify myself with the Word of God. I'm going to memorize the Word of God. I write there, and then I took a piece of paper. I underlined those verses of the prayer of Ezekiel in red in the Bible. I wrote down on a piece of paper, put it in my pocket, my coat pocket. So when I traveled on the tramway, you see, I could memorize that. And I've done that now for 45 years, and I'm still memorizing things, you know. Because Elda says to me, once she said, are you still memorizing? I said, yeah. Why are you memorizing? You know so much of the Bible and everything. I said, well, I need some more. You gotta keep feeding yourself spiritually. And that was the blessing that it was. I saw there a beautiful deliverance. And then I read the rest of the chapter, and it shows that during the night, the angel of the Lord went out. So when the general and his officers woke up in the morning, they look over the camp, and all their soldiers were dead. And they took off from Nineveh before they were done in. And he went to the temple of Nisroch, his god, and Sennacherib, and while he was worshiping there, his sons came in and put a dagger in his back, and he fled to the land of the Arameans. I was very impressed with that, and I left the Bible open there. I had my worship. When my friend came over, the Bible was still there. So,
whenever your friend Roland came over, you had just finished your worship time and you had read the story about Sennacherib. Mm-hmm. What did he say? Did he feel agitated? Was he upset?
Oh yeah. He came in and sat himself down and he said, I can't believe it. Not of all people, he says, not morneau, would do a stupid thing like daring the spirits. No. He said, you're an intelligent man, aren't you? You know, you got a choice. The high priest tells me that if you come to see him with me now, no problem. Everything is going to be straightened out of the spirits. He promised him that already. He got that assurance. And he said, let's do the right thing. Why gamble with your life? I said, well, I'll tell you what. I don't feel like going to see the high priest. Now or ever. And we conversed about a number of things, and he said, well, I hate to have to tell you this, but seeing that you decided that you're not going to have anything to do anymore with the master and his people, I hate to tell you this, that the high priest told me that a price has been put on your life. A medical doctor, remember, he gave me the name, has pledged $10,000 to have you done in.
How did you feel whenever you found out that you had a contract out on your life?
Well, it surprised me a little, but I had prepared myself for something worse. So that I didn't, it didn't bother me too much. Because, see, the strength of the Lord, the word of the Lord was, the Spirit of God was giving me strength.
Okay, was the presence of the Spirit of God evident to Roland there that Sunday morning?
As we talked, and now he decided that, he was losing the battle. He became very nervous. And he got up and went to the door, put his head on the door, and we talked there. He says, "Morneau, please, if it's not for your sake, do it for me. Do you realize what's going to happen to me if something happens to you? I don't know how they're going to treat me." I said, "Hey, man, let me tell you something. I got a suggestion for you. You come with me. I'll guarantee you all the protection that you need to live to ripe old age. And beside that, I'll tell you what. You should go back and tell the high priest and all his boys to come to our church. I'll arrange for my minister to have 100 spaces there, right off the center aisle." I felt like I'm making them an invitation. Well, he says, "Well, I would never say a stupid thing like that." He says, "Well, that's your responsibility." I said, no, things are settled. He lit a cigarette. And as he lit the cigarette, I saw his hand shake like this. And I said, "You're quite nervous." "Well, let me tell you," he says, "there's a power here, a presence that I'm not accustomed to. I'm very uncomfortable because there's a power here that makes me terribly uncomfortable." Well, I said, "You know what it is? The presence of the Spirit of God, the Spirit of the Creator, the Life Giver." And I said, "Every other power is subject unto that higher power. You're aware of that." "Oh, yeah." So that's the way that it ended. He decided to go.
He told you that you had a contract put out in your life.
Yeah.
How did you respond to him? He was nervous, but he said to you, You're walking under the shadow of death, Morneau. How did you respond?
I said, "My friend, I've got some news for you. Not so much for you as it is for the high priest. And now the Spirit of God gave me very special righteous indignation, have you ever heard of that terminology? That when I heard that they were going to do me in, with have me shot, I said, look, I got some news for the high priest and his boys. The day that they wipe me out, do me in, will be the day that the life giver is going to pull the bread of life on all of them except the high priest. And there'll be dead cadavers there in the temple. And tell the high priest this: don't call funeral directors because they don't have enough, not ambulance, but what do you call
coffins?
It? No, the wagon.
Oh, hearses.
I said, "You better call the fire department of Montreal. Then you pile them all up there, the whole 100 of them." I said, "This is what's going to take place." He said, "You're a fool." I said, "You think so? Let me show you something." Picked up the Bible, and I said, "I'm going to tell you a little story. Make it short." He said, "Short, because he says I'm going." I said, "Listen to this. I just read this morning. There's a man by the name of Hezekiah that believed in the Creator a few hundred years back. And let me tell you what happened to him. Sennacherib came with his armies, told him the story. He went before the Lord and prayed about it. And the Lord says the way that Sennacherib came, that's the way he's going to go home. And during the night, 185,000 men were destroyed by the angel of the Lord." So I said, "Don't tell me that I don't know what I'm talking about." I said, "I can assure you that if they put a bullet in me, they're all going to lose out because the Creator will remove the breath of life." And I felt as sure of that as if this was a prediction that I think the Lord would have backed up my word.
So how did he respond after you told him that story?
Well, he said, I guess he says, "I've lost my time. Before we part," he says, I don't want to even shake your hand because you're not a friend of mine no more. I said, have it your way. If ever we meet one another anywhere in the city of Montreal, don't you ever look at me like you know me, because I'll ignore you and embarrass you, he says, wherever we are. I said, fine. No problem with that at all.
Now, Roger shared with you that his former associates that worship demons, that were part of that elite spirit worship group in Montreal, were very unhappy with him, as were the demonic powers, for studying, especially with Seventh-day Adventists.
That's right.
Did he ever share with you or tell you that there might be some danger involved for you?
He did tell us something that rather startled me. He said he got a call from somebody in that organization, and they threatened our lives, and they knew us by name. And of course, nobody followed him. And I had to assume that the powers of darkness were able to communicate to those people that worshipped what our names were. They knew our names. And the things, some of the events that followed were such that I attributed them to demon powers.
Cynthia, there was an event that was a little startling to you and to Cyril, and I know Roger was interested in it as well. You had a fire at your house shortly after the Bible studies were going on. Tell us a little bit about that.
Shortly after the Bible studies, we were living with my father at the time. So we had a very large front room, pretty large front room. And we were sitting in the room, and my brother came up, who had a little problems of his own. And they were using some cleaning fluid to get something off of a piece of clothing. And my brother suggested that it wouldn't burn, and that he wanted to try it out to see if it would or wouldn't burn. And since it was a very large room, I guess he felt that the fumes wouldn't be as concentrated as probably in a smaller room. So he just decided to light a match. And I guess the fumes didn't sink to the ground, but they had risen up to where we were sitting, and the fumes burst in the room at our waist, mm-hmm. as we sat down.
They burst into flames?
Into flames. It burst into flames. The floor was never burned at all. It was just as 3 feet off the ground, I guess. Mm-hmm. And everybody disappeared. And Cyril, he went downstairs to get a blanket. And my brother, he disappeared. I was in further into the room near the window, which was on the front side of the house. And I said, well, it isn't going to stop, so I better do something. So I jumped up on the chair, which turned out to be a stuffed chair, so I wasn't helping myself by any means. Then I looked at the window, which was about 3 feet from me, and I said, well, if I was already on the third floor, and I said, well, I'll jump from the third from the window onto the balcony, which was on the second floor. It was a very small balcony. So I looked at the window, and the curtains had started going up in flames. And I said, you know, I just might miss that balcony and hit the cement. So I said, no, that's not going to work. So I stayed there, and then I just became paralyzed. And the only thing that was working was my mind. And I asked the Lord, I said, Lord, I don't want to die. I just married a year, and my whole life is in front of me, and if you can see any way I can get out of here, please do something. And I waited, and I didn't get any answer. And pretty soon, as if somebody had hit me to knock me off the chair, the force of it, somebody said, jump now, which meant no questions or any other kind of rationalizations I was giving it. And I bent down to start a sort of a broad jump. And at that side of the room, I was at least 8 feet from the door. And I got down, and between me and the door was a radio, a floor-length radio with a lamp on it. And when I got down, when I crouched down to make the broad jump, I was outside of the room before Searle came upstairs with the blanket. I don't remember how I got there.
You were just kind of moved.
I just moved.
And then what happened where you had just been?
The can of gasoline apparently was sitting.
It wasn't gasoline, it was naphtha.
Naphtha was right by the chair, and it blew right up, big hole into the ceiling, just as I moved away. And my hair was burnt, all my face was burnt, and, well, not all, right around here. And my eyebrows were gone. And he asked me, he said, how did you get out of the room? Because by this time the room was totally in flames. And I said, I don't know. I said, but I prayed. And I was there. He didn't need the blanket then.
The Lord answers our prayers in spite of what the devil may try to do to us, doesn't he?
After the fire, and we moved away, and we were getting ready to come to the United States, we, of all places, moved in with an Irish family.
In a French neighborhood.
Partying. They loved to party. But we stayed to ourselves pretty much because we felt that we would soon be leaving the country anyway. And they turned out to be really nice people. But while we were there, we had several different things happen. Like, for instance, we would say our prayers and get in bed, and then the doors would start slamming and the windows would go up and the wind would come through the room. And it terrified us. And so we went to bed every day, every night, with our Bible under our pillow. We'd turn on the light and everything would be calm, like, you know, as you expect. And then this would happen for, it happened for a couple of weeks. And then another thing started. Dishes would act like they were falling out of the closets, and somebody was sweeping with a broom on a hardwood floor, and all kinds of different things. And I was terrified. I wouldn't stay in there, you know, at all.
Did this happen? Excuse me. Did this happen during the Bible studies, or you were giving?
No, this is afterwards.
Right after this.
We had a lot of things happen to us afterwards.
For a couple of months.
So you were harassed by the demonic spirits.
That's right.
For your role in bringing Roger to a knowledge of biblical truth for several months.
For now, several months.
How did it stop?
The powers of darkness don't really stop. The only way you can keep them in check is on your knees, prayer. I don't think anybody is immune to the problems that come about as a result of the devil's work. The devil is working against us full time. He knows his time is short, and there's no way of saying that, oh, he stopped. Because when you say he stopped, that's the time he's going to start. We still have problems today that we know that the devil is behind them. Many of the mistakes that we make, or that we think we make, we've been set up in most cases. And that's why the Lord wants us to pray without ceasing.
Has there ever been a time whenever you were experiencing a difficulty that you felt was the direct result of the demonic forces being angry with you, that you wished that you had never met Roger?
Never.
No.
Never. I'd do it all over again. If the same situation occurred, I'd be willing to do it all over again. Life is not as important as eternity. And a soul is not, cannot be turned away because of your own fear or your own lack of courage. There will never be a time when I'd be sorry.
After the demon left you that Saturday night, did you have any more demon harassment over the next few months, or was it just over instantly?
No, it was not over instantly. Every night, the spirits knocked on the walls, knocked on the doors. I was awakened 2-3 times a night. They were trying to reopen conversation with me. The Lord would not allow them to bother me in any ways, except that they tried to have communication with me. And that, it seems that the Lord See, the Creator has given us freedom of choice. You can choose good or choose evil. You see, that's your prerogative. It's a freedom that He has given us, which is beautiful, freedom of choice. Well, of course, the enemy of the Lord says, hey, I want access to it. At least you can allow me to knock on the door. He responds, you lost him. He's mine. So I knew that very well. And it went for 6 months that the spirits knocked every night.
Did you wonder why they were continuing to do that?
Oh, yeah. I said, hey, thank you, Lord. It's all you allowed them to do. You know, they would love to destroy me, bring the ceiling down and the whole building on me, for that matter. But I said, I figured to myself, this is the thorn in the flesh. See, I'd read 2 Corinthians, the Apostle Paul says, because of the abundance of the revelations that he had received from God and all that, he says, there is given to me a thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above measure. You know, because a human fallen human heart just loves to think good of itself and becomes proud and vain and sin against its creator. And the Apostle Paul says, I'm going to pray about it. He said, for this thing I besought the Lord thrice. 3 times he prayed about it. And the Lord told him, my grace is sufficient for thee. For my strength is made perfect in weakness. Isn't that beautiful? So the Apostle said, therefore, most gladly will I rejoice in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. And I said the same thing to the Lord. Lord, if you want these critters to, you know, be after me all the days of my life and knock and wake me up every night, that's okay with me. That's the least I could put up with, you know.
So when did it stop?
Well, one prayer meeting, the minister says, how's things going? He says, with your Christian walk. I said, sir, couldn't go any better. He says, I'm glad for you. No. This was after the prayer meeting, we're just leaving. And he said, no problem with the spirits at all, huh? Oh, the spirits, well, yeah, they're trying to open communication with me all the time. You knock every night, they wake me up. You do? How can you put up with that? there's no other way. Oh, no, no, he says, wait a minute now. He says, it's my fault I didn't tell you this. He says, the spirits have an open avenue to you that God cannot close. As long as you have in your place the literature that you, or some of the things that you had to do with spirit worship. Do you have anything like that in your place? Oh, yeah, I got 3 books. Then I got some incense. And I got some candles. Well, he said, get rid of all this mess, and you're not going to be part of the spirits anymore. I'm sure of that. Well, I did exactly what he told me. Stopped completely. Okay. Now, today, I'm a blessing to somebody else. A lady wrote me from California. She said, it's very urgent that I get your phone number because I have to talk to you. I cannot write, you know. She said, I couldn't tell you everything in writing. I need to talk to you so greatly because of the fact that I have, I'm being spirit oppressed, demon spirit oppressed. Well, I got the letter, and immediately, oh, she told me, yes, she gave me her phone number, and she said, if you could call me, I'll call you right back. And because she has an answering machine, she's a widow, so she doesn't answer the phone. She always let the machine answer, you know, first before she called anybody back. So I called her up, and she told me what she was up against. She said, you got to help me. Like she says, you've got to help me. You know what I mean? It was, she said, nobody else can.
It wasn't a question, it was a plea.
Yeah. She said, you've got to help me, Brother Morneau. The ministers can't help me over here. And even the president of our conference think I'm crazy. Isn't that sad? Well, I said, exactly what's the problem? And she told me. I'm reading my Bible. And she said, the spirit picked up the Bible and threw it against the wall, like across the room. And when I read your book, I said, this is it. That's the same thing. She told me about being bounced up on her bed, 3 o'clock in the morning, you know, from the ceiling down to the bed, thrown on the bed, and how things move around the house, and she hears a man's voice downstairs, down there. There's nobody. And then she said, the door's open and shut. I go back and check things. Everything is locked. The window's open by themselves and shut.
So what did you tell her?
I told her, lady, I said, you're being demon spirit oppressed. What can we do about it? The ministers, my minister says, won't even talk to me anymore about anything. He says, hi, sister, how have you been today? And he tries to talk to somebody else as soon as possible so that I don't have to tell him that in the past week I had some problems. Well, I said, lady, with God's blessing, you got your problem solved. And I gave her the recipe.
And what's the recipe?
I said, now you're going to have to do something very special. Okay? I'll do anything that you tell me to do that is in accordance with the will of the Lord. I said, you're going to have to acquaint yourself with the power of the blood of Christ, the redeeming power of the blood of Christ, and what he can do for you that you can do for yourself. Besides saving you for eternity, he can redeem you from this oppression. First, I said, before we go into this, tell me, have you ever had anybody in the last few years, because she said it came back, it started a few years back, about 10 years ago, and every two or three years she had this kind of an experience, but it didn't last very long. So I told her, what you have, sister, you have a taint of demon spirit defilement. Demon spirits have got direct access to you, and the Lord cannot really help you there, because you have in your home something that belongs to someone that is involved with the spirits of the dead, the supposed spirits of the dead, which are really demon spirits. As anyone that you know that could be involved with the spirits of the dead? She said, yes, the blind lady. I've been taking care of for the last 2 years, three days per week. She's given me a scarf, she's given me a Bible, she's given me different other things. She said, do you think that could be the thing? After she told me the experience with the old lady, the blind lady, that was it. She didn't want that Bible because the Bible is giving her trouble now. She prays to her mother, and she conversed with her mother. You see, the dead mother.
The blind lady.
The blind lady. And she said, that Bible is giving you trouble. She says, would you like a Bible? So the lady says, well, I've gotten one already. She says, I'm going to give it to somebody. Why don't you take it? So she had taken the Bible. When she brought the Bible home, that was the beginning of the whole thing. Now the spirits were really moving in. And then she gave her a scarf and gave her other things like that. I said, now...
So you told her to get rid of that.
That's right. Now it's 10 o'clock at night. Because she called me back because she was not home. She'd gone to visit her sister 30 miles away. And she came back. And we're talking now at 10 o'clock at night. I said, you want some peace tonight? She says, yes. Take everything, put it in the garage. Then sit yourself down with your Bible and read Matthew, the 27th chapter, the crucifixion of Christ, very attentively and prayerfully and respectfully. You're going to read those 30 verses from verse 24 through 54. And I said, then you talk to the Lord about it and your problems are over. And sure enough, she called me back the next day. I was on a Saturday night. She called me first. Called back. No problem at all. No noise. It's gone. It has not returned. Except once. She phoned me up. She says, there's a problem. Yes? Yes, I hear the walking again. Oh, you do? Have you given away everything I told you that you had gotten from this person? Yeah. But she says, I've been thinking about this. There's a man, she says, that dated me, you know, has been died, right? And a couple of years later, somebody introduced her to this man. And they went out for a few months together, and then she decided that he would never become an Adventist because of the fact that he believed in the spirits of the dead so much, you know, and especially of his cousin. They talk about his cousin all the time. And he had given her a lawnmower. I said, you got a lawnmower in the place? She says, yeah. Get rid of the lawnmower. Take the lawnmower and put it outside of your garage. Don't have it on your property. She called me back. She said, everything's fine.
You mean to tell me now, Roger, that if someone who is a spiritist, mm-hmm, or is involved in any form of spiritualism,
yep,
give something to someone mm-hmm. that they have in their home, mm-hmm. that gives the spirits the right...
An avenue, open avenue. Yeah. Now, a lot of people are afraid that people are going to put an X on them, because if they take a piece of your hair or something that belongs to you, you put an X on you, that's palone. The Lord takes care of all this nonsense. But when a spiritist or somebody that's involved with demon spirits in some form or other gives you anything, and you bring it to your home, the spirits have got access to your home openly at all time, and the Lord cannot help you. I'm sorry to see it.
He cannot help you until you voluntarily remove those things.
That is correct. Yeah.
But that does not mean that he doesn't hold them in check, because they would love to destroy.
Destroy them, yeah. I've come across a lot of people that have been writing to me, and they said they've had demon spirits cast out of them by one of those deliverance ministries. And I have one lady that she's been 10 years now since she had demon spirits casted out of them, out of her. It took 13 hours and praying and talking to the spirits to get the spirits out of her. She said it was like a couple of hundred spirits, you see, in her and all that. And this person's fate has been destroyed completely. Completely destroyed. Now, there are two different, I want to bring this to your attention, there are two different types of people who exorcise demons.
You mean exorcise?
Exorcise,
that's casting demons out.
Casting demon spirits out of people.
Okay.
You have that in the African religions. And then you have it in Christianity today, where people say, if you are fearful of this and fearful of that, you have a demon of fear in you. So what we're going to have to do, we're going to have to cast out a demon for you. And when these people listen to a sermon from one of these people, these pastors...
And there are actually preachers involved in these deliverance
ministries. Oh, yes, definitely. That's what's so sad about it. What happens is they put on a sermon in a church talking about the fact that many of you are undoubtedly demon-possessed. You don't know it.
Is it possible to be possessed by a demon and not know it?
Well, no. Not if you're a Christian. If you are yielding your life to Christ every day, day after day after day, you don't have to worry about demon spirits getting into your life. See? Now, what happened is this. The speaker talks about the fact that he has delivered people from demon spirits. There was 100 spirits that came out. It took 10 hours of praying and of wrestling with the spirits to get them out of there. Now, by the time he's done with his sermon, a lot of the people that have different problems. For instance, one preacher says, if you have this certain type of allergy, this certain allergy, you're demon possessed. Well, this poor sister says she believed that she was demon possessed. And she said, now, if Jesus could not keep me from being demon possessed, what kind of a God is he? In the back of her mind. Thinks about it.
So in reality, what you're saying is that these supposed deliverance ministries mm-hmm. that are dealing directly with the occult and casting demons out of people
are not
dangerous.
Yeah, and dangerous. In Matthew, the 7th chapter, the Lord says, many shall say unto me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name? In your name have cast out devils, in your name done many wonderful works or miracles. And I will preface unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. And this is a strong message that he's giving to somebody, some preacher. Well, it's a tremendous destruction of Christianity that these ministries are doing. They're doing a great disservice to Christ.
What specifically is the problem with a deliverance ministry?
A person that is involved in this type of ministry, where they communicate with the spirits,
They talk with the spirits and ask them their names.
Yeah, yeah. They have lost out completely on Christ. The blood of the atonement has washed away from them. They think they're doing the work of Christ, and they're doing the work of the devil. Because they're tearing people's faith down in Christ. There's one lady that's been calling me every week now, every year Friday night, and she's a commitment-giving person. Or on Sunday, calls me for a year and a half, as soon as my book on prayer came out. She's had demons cast out of her and all that. that person's fate is solo, that I wonder how she's able to keep alive, keep believing in Christ. She called me here at 11:30 at night, Christmas Eve, last Christmas. I answered the phone. She said, "Brother Morneau, I got to talk to you. I'm sorry to have called you so late." And she cries, and she cries. And I said, "Lady, what is the problem?" And she finally was able to stop crying. And then she told me, "I was just washing the dishes a while ago, and a man's hand was placed on my left shoulder. I quickly turned around, there's nobody there." So she says, "The same spirit that has been trying to see the wheels off my car and driving down the road." See? She had that experience also. The wheels were coming loose. She pulled in the service station and said, "Something wrong with my car." The guy says, "Well, yes, you look at that, the nuts have gone on your front wheel." So he tightens the nut. She gets back in the car, tightens the nuts, I should say, there's five of them, drive down another mile, and the same thing happens to do the same on the back. She stopped at a service station, and the guy says, "Yeah, look," he says, "the nuts are coming off the wheel."
And this is a lady who had all these hundreds of devils cast out of her 10 years ago.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So she said, "What am I going to do?" I said, "You're going to do what you need to do. Fortify yourself in the merits of the blood of Christ. And then I have to rebuild her confidence in the power of the Creator." See? Talk to her about Colossians, about the creative power of Christ, that we are complete in Him, which is the head of all principality and powers. See? He's created them all. So anyway, that this lady, she told me, she said, "Would you mind if I call you every week? Because it seems that when I talk with you, I regain faith in the merits of the blood of Christ, enough to be able to sustain myself for a week." But then she says, "If I don't call you, by the middle of the week," she says, I'm ready, she says, "to die." You know? She's a person of responsibility. I won't say where she works. She works for the federal government. And she's in a high position, highly paid person, and superly educated, and a beautiful person, you know, and beautiful intellect. But the person, she says, "I'll never recover from this thing." I said, "Yes, sir, sister, you will recover from this. Don't you worry."
What did you recommend to her?
Well, it would be quite lengthy to go into it, because she has such a bad case of everything, you see.
But you just have a few of these really hardcore cases that you work with very carefully.
Mm-hmm.
But some of them are wrecks after having gone through the deliverance ministries. Mm-hmm. That's the important thing.
Yeah, because once they've been told by a preacher, if they were told by the grocery manager down the supermarket that they were demon-possessed because they have such an affliction, It wouldn't destroy the faith in Christ. But when a man that says, "I'm a minister of the gospel," stands in a pulpit, and he says, "If you have these certain fears or whatever it is, you are undoubtedly possessed by a demon." Now, the first thing that hits the mind is that, what kind of a savior do I have that couldn't keep me from becoming demon-possessed? The power of suggestion, we are told, is the greatest force on earth known to man. Mm-hmm. Alexander the Great, that conquered the world, he used the power of suggestion. He didn't want to use his armies. He said, I used the armies as the last resort. I used the power of suggestion, he says. So he had his, they would camp themselves around the city, and they would have speakers that would go and speak every morning and evening to the people that were in the city, telling them to give up. You're not going to come out of this alive. And by tearing down the mind to the fact, to the possibility that they will survive, then negative thoughts come in, and the people said, "Let's give in. He's going to have us anyway." And history tells us that he won the world not by the sword, but by the words that he spake, or that his people speak for him. So the power of suggestion is the greatest force on earth known to man, that's been established by knowledgeable people. And when a minister of the gospel stands up in the pulpit and he says to the people that even though you're a Christian, you can be demon-possessed, and you undoubtedly are, he destroys faith in the merits of the blood of Christ completely. When that fate goes down to a zero figure, you know what can take place then? Demon spirits can come right in. An avenue to the soul, man. And they camp home and they said, we got it. So, the preacher says, now at 7 o'clock tonight, we're going to meet here and have a service. Get these demons out. Get yourself prepared to maybe stay all night and pray all night for these demons. You see, one person, there's a number of people that called me and told me about these things. And people that have, like mothers that have had daughters that had, you know what I mean? Demons and all that possessing them. Sad to say. A lot of them killed themselves. And the preacher will get there and they're going to start praying over this person, demon possessed. And talk with the demon and find out the name of the demon and find out where the demon has been doing for centuries. And they get all kinds of really interesting insights on the supernatural. The spirits love it. And they come out when they feel like it. But it's in their interest to keep right on talking with the preacher and say, I'm not going to go out. You know? And then another voice comes out and says, well, I'm Christine, you know, and another personality of hers and another demon and all that. And,
it's all demon games is what you're
demon
saying.
Demon games, yeah. And by the time that the spirits are all out, the person is almost dead.
Roger, there have been several people who have contacted you with special problems. And you have developed a 7-point plan to help someone who is either has messed with the occult or is involved in the occult or is being harassed. Would you share with us just the high points of that 7-point plan?
Sure. I've had a number of people that have written me or phoned and were highly distressed because of the fact that, you know, they were harassed by demon spirits and they couldn't understand why. Now, on page 534 of the Great Controversy, there is a two-line statement here that I'd like to bring your attention. Satan is seeking to overcome men today as he overcame our first parents by shaking their confidence in their Creator. Interesting, isn't it? Now, as I mentioned before, earlier, once a religious leader stands in the pulpit and convinces people that they are demon possessed and their fate goes down to a zero figure, demon spirits move in then, for real. And they exorcise these people and these spirits, I should say, and etc. But then I came up with a plan that people can really get some help and get it quick. Now here's, I have written down here is a 7-step recovery program for those who are oppressed by demon spirit and who have been victimized through so-called deliverance ministries. They're not really deliverance, they involve you more in that which is destroying your Christian experience or will separate you from God. Point number one, throw out or destroy all literature that one has on deliverance ministries. Get rid of everything that they've given you. Demon spirits have a right to stay with all objects that bear the taint of their defilement.
So it's not just items that relate to the occult they should get rid of, which they should get rid of, but also anything that has to do with the deliverance ministry.
That's right.
Okay.
Do not speak to demon spirits, even if it is to command them to depart in the name of the Lord Jesus. Like I have done it before I was knowledgeable with the Word of God.
Let me just understand that. That if a person is confronted, they should not even command a demon spirit to leave in the name of Jesus Christ, not even talk to them. What should they do?
When let me bring something to your attention. When Jesus, a number of times in the Bible, we read that Jesus casted out demon spirits out of people. In this one instance, for instance, the spirits wanted to talk, that he was a son of God. And Jesus forbid them to talk because they are lying spirits. They'll say 3 or 4 words of truth and 10 of lies. And you put it all together and people feel, you know, you talk about the Lord Jesus so nicely, it's got to be of the Lord, you see. And it's not so in the world of spiritual conflict.
If a person is in a situation where demonic power is evident.
Mm-hmm.
They are not to even command that spirit to leave in the name of Jesus Christ. What? How are they to get rid of them? Do they kneel down and pray? No. Do they let the Holy Spirit do it?
Yes.
What do they do?
You do it. You do it by the power of the Spirit of God. Now Jesus told the Jews that he casted out demons through the power of the Holy Spirit. He informed them on that. And the Apostle Paul, we read in the 19th chapter of the book of Acts, went to Ephesus, and Ephesus was a cult area of all kinds of occultism, of demon spirit involvement. It was a great center of occultism in the Roman Empire. And there he remained there for 2 years. And with 12 of his followers that he met there, they prayed for these Ephesians. They were pagans. They were, you know, there was no Christians living there at all. And we are told that he did a tremendous work, or I should say better than that, the Holy Spirit did a tremendous work as a result of their prayers. And the Spirit of God rested upon Paul so much that people would even come to him and with handkerchiefs and with aprons, it says. And the Bible says, and I quote verses 11 and 12, says, "And God wrought special miracles by the hands of Paul, so that from his body were brought unto the sick handkerchiefs and aprons. And the diseases departed from them, and the evil spirits left them." Or, you know. So the Holy Spirit, the power of the Holy Spirit, is what does the cleansing and the getting rid of demons. You don't even have to mention, get out in the name of Jesus. And that is it's a fallacy. I'll tell you why. It's dangerous. That's what it is. Because the spirits will reply to you most of the time. And you get involved with them, and you're a loser. Because you become tainted.
So immediately then, if you are confronted with a demonic power, the thing you would do is pray and ask the power of the Holy Spirit to remove that demonic force. That's the correct procedure.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I've dealt with people that were demon-possessed, no question about it, in my business of yellow page advertising. Certain persons that nobody wanted to hang into the account. This guy is weird. One guy says, "I think he's demon-possessed." He was a Baptist. He said, "I think this guy's demon-possessed. I will never handle this account again." Yeah, I go in there and the guy is blaspheming and hitting the desk with his fist, and he's talking to somebody over the phone, telling them to go somewhere in a real big hurry. And I just start praying for the Holy Spirit of God, through the ministry of the blood of Christ shed on Calvary, to do the work which Jesus said he would do. And by asking for the blood of Christ to be appropriated to this man, and that his sins be forgiven him. He probably hasn't confessed his sins in 20 years. He has no desire to. But he's entitled to the freedom and the deliverance that Christ gives to us through his shedding of his precious blood. And I've seen people just like a big balloon that you put a pin into. Whew. The pressure is gone. The guy smiles. I haven't smiled in a month. You know? One guy says, "Hey, man," he says, "you know something? You've been here 10 minutes, and it's the only 10 minutes I've had of rest in the last week." He says, "What are you anyway?" You know, he says, "You got a special power with you, man."
Did you tell him it was the Spirit of God with you?
I didn't tell him right there and then, but I did a little later.
You mentioned 2 points. What's your third point? Go ahead and review the first
okay.
two. The first
you one, throw away all literature and all matter of materials that has been related to these either deliverance ministries, or if you're involved with occultism, some form or other. Don't speak to the spirits. Ignore them completely. And you just ask for the Lord, by the power of his Holy Spirit, in the merits of the blood of Christ, to drive away the spirits. Now you say, "Where do you get this thing?" Well, I have a lot of verses from the Bible that I could prove it to you from. But I want to read you a quotation from page 431 of The Desire of Ages, because it puts it real the way I like to have it. "Earnest, persevering supplications to God in faith can alone avail to bring men the Holy Spirit's aid in the battle against principalities and powers, the rulers of the darkness of this world, and wicked spirits in high places." And I've proven this for 45 years. This is not new to me. This is what I've experienced over the years.
See? Excellent.
Yeah. Now, part three is early in the morning, read about the crucifixion of Christ. It takes 4 minutes without having to rush through it. Matthew 27 chapter, read verses 24 through 54. It'll take you from Pilate's judgment hall and bring you to Golgotha, and there you will see the Son of God expire on the cross, and the earthquake took place, and even the Roman pagan says, truly this was the Son of God. See?
And as you read that, you visualize it and you're actually there.
Oh, yeah.
Each morning.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely.
Okay.
And it'll change your life. One man phoned me up. He says, I've been going to Golgotha every morning now. He says, from Pilate's judgment hall to Golgotha every morning, like you told me last year, my life has changed. And not the same person.
Praise the Lord.
He says, I got a different view and understanding of the conflict between the force of good and evil. I understand more exactly what Jesus did for me. And he couldn't stop telling how what it had done for his life. Now, you must ask God, even if it's in the middle of the afternoon, you pray 10 times before that, okay? You're going to pray for about someone, or in a case like this, say, Lord, before I ask you for your help, I want you to make sure that if I have offended you in thoughts, words, and deeds, that you remove the offenses by the merits of the blood of Christ. I always make sure that I have a clean slate. Because the Bible tells us that the human heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. And there's a lot of wickedness in passing our thoughts, man. Even if we don't stop ourselves to look at it, you know. And you have to pray for faith and for the power of Christ to save you. Now, we're told by the pen of inspiration that faith is inspired by the Holy Spirit. And it flourishes only as it is cherished. I will talk to you only right now about the first part. It's inspired by the Holy Spirit. So if we need the faith, where do we go? We go to Christ or to the Father, and we plead for this very special blessing. And it'll always be given you. Blessings that are marvelous. Point seven is to memorize the Word of God in order to live a victorious, successful Christian life. And to memorize the Word of God, it automatically brings you faith, hope, joy in the Lord. And that is power.
Roger, on the last book that you wrote on intercessory prayer, mm-hmm. did you experience any harassment at that time?
Yes, some.
So the demon spirits from 45 years ago still didn't want you talking.
That's right. As I started to write the manuscript, I wasn't very gone into it more than maybe, well, I'd written the first chapter of it just for the kids to have something to read after. If I pass away, they'll have something to know how the old man was able to pray, and the Lord blessed, you know, my experience in the hospital in Canada. But then, after Daniel had told me, Dad, you should write a book, and I said, no, I'm no writer. When it comes to prayer, there's been so many books written on prayer. So he said, why don't you just write Mr. Richard Coffin, that helped you with your first book, and Review and Herald, see what he says about it. But Mr. Coffin wrote back and says, yes, send us the 11-page manuscript that you have. We want to look at it. And then, of course, the good news came that they wanted me to submit two more chapters, and then the entire manuscript. Well, as soon as I started the second chapter, it was during the daytime, the garage door started to open. Now, this is an old garage door. This house, by the way, is 100 years old, a little over 100 years old. The part next to it is new, fairly new. But that garage door is probably 40 years old, and it's one of those rollers up and down with the big springs, and it makes a terrible noise when you raise it and when you lower it. Especially when you get to be, when you bring it down, it's about a foot from the floor. If you happen to let go of the handle, it hits that concrete, and the glass panes, the panes of glass rattle. You know, makes a lot of noise. And it opened two or three times. I paid no attention to that. Hilda calls me from upstairs, says, come down here and see who's playing at the garage door. I said, I come down. I said, everything's all right. She says, you just sit here and you watch and see. She says, this door has been opening three times, she says, in the last half hour. Oh. And she said, didn't Greg mowed the lawn yesterday? Because I told him, I said, maybe Greg came to get the lawnmower or something, he's going to do the lawn. No, he did it yesterday, he said. Well, I got thinking right away. I can't believe it. See, I thought of the spirits right away. But I said, don't worry about it, it's nothing at all. Sure enough, I was going up the staircase, I hear the thing rolling up and then rolling down. So I said, I'm going to go out there. I went out there, and there was nobody around at all. So I came back in to the Hilda. It's not going to happen again. She says, what do you mean it's not going to happen again? How do you know? I said, I don't know. There's a lot of teenagers around here. They must have opened the door and run. You see? Well, I knew exactly what had taken place. Because that evening, when she went to work, she worked night shift at the hospital. I started to write again. When I started to write, the door started to roll up and down. Every 20 minutes, 25, 30 minutes, the door would roll up and down. And it would hit concrete, man, and make an awful noise.
So what went through your mind?
Well, I prayed about it. I said, Lord, the spirits don't want me to write this book. But I'm not working for the spirits, I'm working for you. Okay? And I said, if you want me to tell my prayer experience, my prayer life for the last 45 years, you're going to have to help me get rid of those spirits. But it turned out that all that night, that door must have opened 50 times. Because I wrote till 3:30 or 4 o'clock in the morning. So I realized I was not going to be able to write during the daytime. And the next night, same exact same thing. And it went every night that I wrote, wrote that manuscript. And I tell you what, I told the Lord, the next night, he did it again. I said, Lord, it's okay. You know, this is not heaven on earth. We're in the land of the enemy. So I can't put up with that, you know, as long as my wife is not scared to death. And that's what happened. I wrote the manuscript like this.
And as soon as you finished the manuscript, it stopped.
Stop. Yeah.
But you know, I can understand why the devil is so angry. You are giving a snapshot mm-hmm. of a side of his work that very few people have ever had an opportunity to see and live to tell about. Mm-hmm. And Ellen White tells us that there is nothing that the devil fears more, Roger, mm-hmm. than that his methods and his devices will be discovered and people will have a natural defense against them. Mm-hmm. So I can understand exactly why he was upset. But praise the Lord, the Lord's power was stronger and continues to be stronger.
The Lord has been gracious to me over the years. I've been in some situations on the road with trucks and storms and snow and sleet and things. I was traveling so much. I was traveling anywhere between 25 to 35,000 miles a year. And that's a lot of miles to put on the road all the time. And I've seen so many instances where I could have been killed, man. Well, as a matter of fact, in my book on prayer, I talk about two or three incidents there.
Well, it occurs to me that there's an old rule that says if you play with fire, you're going to get burned.
Yep.
And fortunately for you, 45 years ago, you were rescued, kind of a brand from the burning.
That's right.
Roger, and your testimony lives on.
Yeah.
You've walked under the shadow of death for 45 years, according to the priest, but if I read correctly in your book, you said you wouldn't mind that as long as the Creator walked with you. And
That's
he
right.
has,
yeah.
hasn't he?
Mm-hmm. Definitely.
You've been watching the conclusion to A Trip into the Supernatural, a two-part interview with best-selling author Roger Morneau. This exclusive interview was conducted by Dan and Karen Houghton of Heart Research Center.